Hi, ladies and gentlemen. Sorry, my
voice. That was like cracked. The best voice crack ever.
My voice just cracked big time.
Speaking about things that didn't live up to the hype, the Oscars.
Don't jump right into the topic. You're going to introduce yourself on Rant.
Rave.
Repeat.
I'm Liam Grogan.
You got to do it one more time.
Repeat.
No. You get it. Rant, rave, repeat. You're Liam Grogan. I'm Travis Snell. And yes, today we're, I think, doing a little bit of a little bit of both ranting and raving about the Oscars.
Yeah.
As you as a film buff and as me as a film buff, I think we both love film, and the Oscars is kind of like the Super Bowl for us. You know, it's the playoffs. Well, no, the playoffs already happened. This Sunday is literally, it's happened on Sunday, funny enough. Like, it's the Super Bowl. It's a big game. It's one of the things I look forward to every year, even though many people complain, including myself, like, oh, this thing getting on, this thing. It's still, like, the high standard in film and whatnot.
Yeah.
So what are the, how do you feel about the Oscars in general?
It kind of doesn't really feel like an Oscar year. Do you know what I mean?
No, it doesn't. I agree, because I almost feel like next year is going to be that, because there's already talks of people winning next year. Like, have you heard of the movie A Birth of No Nation?
Yeah.
A Birth of Nation? That, to apparently, is like, that's winning an Oscar. So it's like, I already feel like there's a build where this year, and I think we'll get into that too, is probably because the best picture, I think, is so kind of a little up in the air. Usually there's a bunch of front runners, but
yeah. I know I haven't seen all of the films, but yeah. I've seen a good majority of them.
Yeah.
This is probably the first year that I've really tried to see.
I've seen all but one.
A lot of them, but
but yeah, we'll get into that.
A lot of them, they just don't, you know, okay, and we were talking about this off cast.
Yeah.
I hate movies that are made for, like, Oscar fodder.
Mm-hmm.
There's some movies that you see it and you're like, it's not that it wasn't a bad film or it's not enjoyable, but it was, like, made purely to win awards.
It was made with the intention of, like, hey, people are going to look at this for the
awards.
Yeah,
and it doesn't, this Oscars doesn't seem like that. It seems like they just took some really interesting stories or movies or...
There's a couple in there still that follow that, like the Danish Girl.
Yes, I feel like... I'd say that, which obviously that's actually one that I haven't seen. But,
yeah, it's definitely like, that's how I know, like, you might not like it. And I liked enough, it was good, but it definitely has those tropes of like, okay, this feels like...
A controversial enough story, material,
yeah,
that's
exactly.
Like,
and
it's
great
topical.
Acted.
Yeah, it's well acted.
We're never
going to
say that.
Story,
that's why it is Oscar bait. Any movie to me that is Oscar bait... People do take that as a bad thing. And it can be, but at the same time, you know there's going to be great acting, no matter what.
Yes.
And the Danish Girl has great acting. But, yeah, that's what we're going to do today. We're going to do two things. We're going to look at the Oscars this Sunday and do a few little predictions. And then we're going to go down the list of, from 1995 to now, of movies if we felt the best picture was the true winner. Because we'll start off with a little spoiler that I guess we both love Mad Max. We talk about that a lot.
Yeah.
And we feel like that should win best picture, right? You're in agreement? If you...
Yes.
Yeah, but that's why we're going to do the list later, because I think there's many times where there's movies that should have won or could have been a better choice, but because of time or something, it didn't happen. So you look at all the films. So Best Motion Picture, The Best Short, The Martian, Brooklyn, The Revenant, Bridge of Spies, Room, Mad Max, and then Spotlight. I think it will be Revenant, but I think it could be any one of the four between that, Mad Max, Spotlight, and Big Short. The reason it could be Mad Max is somehow they could cancel each other out, the other three, and it just...
That's what I've heard as well.
And I hope. I really hope.
Mm-hmm.
But I think The Revenant is a strong choice. Do you feel like...
I feel like The Revenant would win because, I mean, technically, that movie is gorgeous. Like,
yeah.
The use of, like, natural light, the cinematography, the acting is really good.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, those things can be said about Mad Max, but The Revenant just seems kind of more... Oscar material.
Yeah, definitely. Where I feel like, though, Mad Max, where Revenant feels Oscar material, Mad Max just feels like great film material. Like, to me, Revenant people will look at and appreciate, where Mad Max, I think people will look at and change how film is made and change, like, I want to do something like that. I want to use practical effects. Where
I think that practical effects is a good thing that you brought up, because there's been a lot of talk lately that people are saying, no, practical effects, that's what really makes films look good.
Yeah.
And it really allows you to kind of give it that suspension of disbelief that, yeah, you know you're watching a film, but it looks and feels real, and it's not that overly CGI that we've really kind of started to see in the last 10 years.
And I hope that's a comeback. And that's why I like Mad Max. That's why I wish it would win Best Picture. I don't know if it will. Truthfully, I don't think it will. So that's why I'm pulling for The Revenant. Some people are pulling for Spotlight. I'm not a big fan of Spotlight. I liked it a lot. Very well made. But to me, that's a very Oscar-based movie. And to me, it just feels like a higher-budget HBO movie in a way. Like,
okay.
I like it a lot. But we've talked about this a couple times when you said, like, The Room, you'll never watch again. Spotlight, I'll never, ever watch again. I have no reason, because it was nothing to... intriguing, and this is no offense to the victims, but I feel like the story is almost a bit too late, because this takes place in 2003, and I feel like this movie should have come a lot sooner than 2016, right? Like, I feel like this hot button issue of the church and whatnot, it doesn't feel like a hot button issue right now anymore. It's also something that still happens, but it broke, and it was like a hot button issue for like 5 years. So I feel like people talk about being, and they have the right to say that, but it's just like, for me, it was one of those things that it felt a little, not dated, but just kind of, why did this movie take so long? You know, if this happened 5 years ago, I could have seen like, okay, this makes complete sense. But it felt like a little like, oh, okay. Like,
it almost kind of like, lately The Simpsons has been guilty of that. Like I still watch it regularly, mm-hmm. but there'll be times where they'll like jump on a topic, yeah. and it's like, oh, that was like topical or like a thing like a year and a half ago.
Yeah.
Like, I think they did like an Avatar thing like 2 years after it was released. It's kind of like, oh, that would be great, like, at that time, but...
And yeah, there's a lot of great performances. It's very well shot. It's But it's just... It's a lot of... I don't know. And this is the whole thing. It comes down to personal taste. It's a lot of people in a boardroom talking about, like, stories and this mm-hmm. and that, where, for me, a Best Picture Spotlight is a great, great nominee, but I feel like something like Mad Max or The Revenant or, hell, even The Martian, to be honest, I would prefer. And even some of The Big Short, I would prefer over Spotlight, because Big Short, to me... It was covering something that's more current to me, because the financial crisis was not too long ago. Yeah. And the way it was shot and done, not shot, but more edited, like with the Margot Robbie bathtub scene and stuff, there was more chances taken in The Big Short, where I feel like Spotlight is very, other than the story it's telling, is very by the numbers. Of
yeah.
Like,
oh, and even like last year, they had Philomena was nominated.
Yeah.
Which is, oh, I can't remember. Was it Judi Dench?
Yeah.
It was, yeah, Judi Dench is Steve Hoon. So Judi Dench's character who mm-hmm. had a child that the Catholic Church took away. So, like, you kind of see, like, that theory pop up, and I guess people are talking about it, but it almost seems safe.
Yeah.
Which is
also... It feels like you're going to get a nomination. Yeah. As long as you have great actors in there, mm-hmm. I feel like... And it's bad to say, like, we don't say this thing with any of these. These are all...
Oh, no, yeah.
Great films. It's like judging pretty much the best of the best. It's just saying, like, this is not the worst of the... This is, like, yeah. Not the best of the best line. Like, these movies are here for a reason. Like, there's none of these movies... The only one on the Best Picture list that I haven't seen is Bridge of Spies, so I haven't seen... But none of these movies, I would say, like, oh, yeah, Spotlight was bad. Like, no, I'd say that's a great, really well-made mm-hmm. film. To me, I actually gave that an 8 out of 10 if I had to score it, but it's one of these things of... It's really good, but it's not... I didn't look at it and be like, this is a Best Picture. And it has a lot of votes. Like, it's won other awards. So that, to me, is the biggest threat to Revenant. Big Short could, because it's won some awards as well, and Mad Max, I think, is a threat just because... That chance. I don't think anyone else is on here. Hopefully that hype train
keeps coming.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The Martian. No.
Did you see Brooklyn?
What? Yeah. It's
kind of boring.
It's a cute, fun little film, but like I like
extremely well done. Yeah. It was great. Really well acted.
They're all well acted.
Not a whole lot really happened. And like, and we were talking about this offcast as well. I just saw Room very recently.
Me too.
And my only complaint was that I don't think it went far enough into the material. Mm-hmm. I really wanted to delve into the relationship, especially with William H. Macy's character, the dad.
Yeah.
And her.
But she goes away right away.
Yeah. Right away. And it was, but like that scene when they're at the table and he just can't look at the kid. And, like, how hard that was for the parents. Mm. And, like, yeah, you see it, but I wanted more.
Yeah.
Like, and because it really brought me into it, and I really like that, I think his name's, like, John Tremblay, played the child. Jack Tremblay, yeah.
They gave him the same name as to be.
And I just, it was really good. I just wanted more of it. But, like, like you said, I would never watch that again. It's,
see,
like,
and I
I've
would.
Seen it, I liked it, but I've not... Yeah. I would never really be tempted.
Jacob. Sorry, it's Jacob.
Oh, Jacob Tremblay.
Sorry, right. Jacob, if you're listening to this.
Yeah, this whole podcast is just going off the rails now.
I'm sure he's listening to us, the kid that's way more famous than us at the age of, like, 7. But
yeah.
See, I will watch Room again. I said to you off-cast, I really like Room. It's really good. Like, I think for me it is kind of like up 8 and above, where I feel it kind of falls apart, but where it just gets weaker is when she tries to commit suicide. Sorry, big spoilers. If you haven't seen these movies, you're going to be a little bit spoiled. We have to talk about them because it's the content of the film. Mm-hmm. And I feel like it's just... I said to you, like, it feels like a TV episode in the middle of, like, if this was a series.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, with the family, and then she just kind of comes back. And I love the ending of them going back to the room, and he says bye mm-hmm. to all the
stuff. Well, that's how the book ended as well. In the book, there's also, like, extra scenes of them dealing with it.
Yeah.
And I wanted more of that.
Yeah, like, and it's only 2 hours. I felt like, especially with it, obviously... And this is one thing, I feel like it was not planned to be an Oscar movie, and that's what I do like about The Room. It's not mm-hmm. Oscar bait.
Yes.
And that's why they didn't have 2.5 hours, but I almost would have been fine with this being 2:20 or 2.5. It's like right under 2 hours, and it felt like if there was another 15 to 20 minutes of more scenes, because that's the thing with the movie, I feel like there's not much tension. The interview scene's good, but there's not much tension there. When she kills herself, there's still not that much tension because you don't really feel like she's going to die. Yeah, when she tries to kill herself, there's not that much tension because you feel like she's not going to die.
Yeah.
So that's what my problem, I guess, with the middle of it was. There was just no... It didn't feel... Other than seeing the kid become more normal, there wasn't really anything going on. I guess that was good to see, but it was just... It felt really out of place, almost. The whole movie was kind of not... It was either highly intense... trying to survive. Yeah. And then... Highly intense or highly, like, I can't even say intellectual. It seeing how the family would deal with it and her being back and everything. But then just that middle was just like, oh, yeah, he's just normal. And I guess it was kind of okay, but maybe... I don't know. Because the book is not based on a true story, right? It's just a book.
No, but it's obviously heavily influenced.
Yeah, and like I said, this to him offcast. Like, I mean, no offense to anybody that's gone through that situation, but I didn't like her trying to kill herself because it was just really... I didn't buy it in the movie at that point because the only thing they really show is just that interview. And to me, the interview doesn't go that bad. She says a couple things and they're kind of like, okay, we'll move on. And then she just tries to kill herself right away. I understand the pressure, but it's like she was trapped there for 7 years. You would think... She's finally out. You want to kill herself? Like I said, if that's happened, I don't mean offense. But in the movie, it didn't feel warranted. That's the
thing to me is, there is those scenes, and it was very good, but I just wanted more of it. I really just wanted more of them trying to acclimatize themselves with the family again, and with, like, because even, how would you even, after that, like, I was talking with some of my friends that I'd watched it with, like, imagine the first boyfriend that you'd ever have after that.
Yeah. Like, they could have jumped a few more years.
Or, could that even happen? Or what about the kid?
Yeah. Like, going to school.
And how does she deal with that now that, like, you've literally spent 7 years in, like, a 10x10 room with someone?
Yeah.
How do you, like, even the kid always wanted to sleep with her, right? How do you break that cycle, right? Yeah. Like, imagine the first sleepover that kid goes to.
Yeah.
Like, so
or imagine any strangers that approach him. Yeah. HBO. Talk to us. We're pitching Room the Series right now. I could see that being a 3-season thing of like.
I don't know about a 3-season. I could definitely give it a nice 10-episode arc, kind of like a BBC thing.
I think it could at least go 2 because we didn't get to see any of that court case. We didn't even get to see the guy arrested.
Oh, that's true.
There's lots of stuff there that like I could see a nice True Detective. You're right. Could be 1 season, but I could see 1 to 2 seasons of a minute. Like even BBC style, like 6 episodes of 3 seasons. Like I could see that, but. Great film, but I don't think that'll win. Brooklyn is just kind of like a nice...
Yeah.
It's a nice movie that they threw... Like, it's... I don't know if... I guess it deserves a nomination. It's... I don't want to say it's Oscar bait, but it's definitely something they like. I don't think they're baiting them, but it's something they like.
Bridge of Spies. Apparently, that's the hardest word to say of the
day. Have you seen it?
No, I fell asleep. I started, and then it was...
And I want to, because I really love Spielberg, says everybody, but, like, I'll watch anything Spielberg does. Like, I actually was saying this thing. I actually kind of like Lincoln. Like, I know it's people think it's kind of boring, but I actually like Lincoln. But I'll watch anything he does. I just haven't got around to it, and it's just there are so many movies, especially with them being 8 categories. Like, I honestly feel like, or sorry, not 8 categories, 8 nominees. I feel like, so what are the main ones? It's Mad Max, Spotlight, Revenant, Big Short. I feel like if you did those, and then one, if you could pick one more, add the 4 between Martian, Brooklyn, Bridge, Spies, and Room.
I'd say The Martian, just because I really enjoyed the book, I really enjoyed the movie, and I really like Matt Damon.
It's really, I don't know what I would choose between The Room and Martian. The only reason I would choose The Martian, or The Room, I guess, is because more actor and other nominated things for it, so it would fit the theme better. But this is why, and we'll get into later on, the only reason they brought in that whole 8 thing, well, they don't admit it, but it's definitely the dark night of that whole thing of, like, it didn't get nominated, people were kind of like, why didn't you know it? Then the next year, it's like, we have 10 nominees, but it's like, you can't re-nominate The Dark Knight, it's gone. So that's why I feel like, this could go, like, there's some, I don't know, there's some years it's tricky, and that's where you, feel, like, when you said it's not, like, feels like an Oscar year, there's some year where it feels like, man, there's so many good movies,
like, I was going through some of them, and, like, I think it was a couple years ago, it was pretty weak, and then, like, the year prior to that, any one of them could have taken it, and I was like, those are all great films, so.
And this doesn't feel like a weak year, it just feels like in the middle, where I feel like, if it was back to 5, Brooklyn could go. Bridge of Spies could go, and then I said, Room or Martian, I think could go. Like, I feel like these 4, the Max, Spotlight, Revenant, and Big Short, those are your 4 solid, and it's kind of up in the air. Like, there's a chance. Then you got your 5th of Room for great acting or Martian for great cinematography and whatnot. Yeah. Like, I feel like 5 would have felt good, and that's where I feel like this year with the 8, it kind of feels less because those other ones are kind of like, yeah, those are good. Like, Brooklyn's like, yeah, that's good, but it's not like. That's not a movie I'm really going to watch again. You know? Yeah. Like, I'll watch it. Maybe if it's on TV. I wouldn't say, like, oh, awful, but it's just there's some movies you see. So I'm saying Mad Max. I want to win, but who I think would win, I'll pick The Revenant.
I'm with you on that one.
I'm hoping not for Spotlight. I really like Spotlight, but it's the same year as we'll get into it later. But the whole thing why I was very happy Birdman won over Boyhood. So now Best Actor. So Best Performance by an Actor in a Leading Role: Bryan Cranston for Trumbo, which I have not seen Trumbo. But lots of people are kind of just saying it's like a kind of Brooklyn nomination. I'm like, yeah, nice film, good performance, and good for him.
I love Bryan Cranston.
So I imagine it's good. It's just the previews I saw, I'm like, I don't know if I'm going to enjoy it. Like, it just, nothing grabbed me. It is and that's where, like, maybe I'm at fault, but it is very a trailer type of age, where the second I see a trailer, if it grabs me, I'm going to go see that movie. But if it doesn't, I kind of write off until enough people say it's good.
Yeah.
And I've seen people on Twitter, but, like, I've literally not met a person I know that's seen Trumbo. So it's like,
yeah, that's true, actually.
If everyone's coming to me like, this is a great movie, but okay, I'm going to go out to my local theater by, what is that one downtown that's shitty?
The Paramount.
Like, the Paramount that just has a lot of Oscar movies. I'll go see it, but it's like, no one said anything about this movie. So I'll get to it when it's on Netflix, but right now. So anyways, Bryan Cranston, Michael Fassbender for Steve Jobs, Matt Damon for The Martian, Eddie Redmayne for The Danish Girl, and then Leo for Revenant. So we talk about Cranston. Fassbender, I think, had a good shot at the beginning of the year, but that seemed to go right away when Leo came.
Yeah, I'm actually surprised Matt Damon got nominated.
I'm not, because the movie, except for the middle, is almost a one-man show, pretty much. Like, I guess Chiwetel's in there a lot, but like, I feel like the movie is just his movie. So, I feel like it's good. Eddie Redmayne, that's good,
too. I feel like he's going to win it, though.
Eddie Redmayne?
I got a sneaky suspicion that they're going
to
give it to him.
There's a lot of people that think that, but I don't think so.
I think it should be between Fassbender and Leo.
Yeah,
but I just got a feeling Eddie's going to win it.
The reason I really hate this, because I feel like Fassbender, after Leo wins, is going to become him. Not as much, because like, people don't... he's still not a movie star. People, I still guarantee you go see, talk to random people who Michael Fassbender is. They still know, and he's in so much. But
yeah,
like... What happened was, when Shame... I'm a big Michael Fassbender fan, so I know this. But when Shame came out, everyone's like, this guy, like, Best Picture nominee for sure, or Best Actor for sure, possibly winning, didn't even get nominated. 12 Years a Slave, when that happened for Supporting Actor, was just like, oh yeah, he has it in the bag. And then Jared Leto came up with Dallas Buyers Club, which I truthfully don't think he should have won for that.
No, I don't either.
That's my biggest thing. I think Fassbender... Have you seen 12 Years a Slave?
Yeah.
His performance as a slave... I love Michael Fassbender. I fucking hated him in that movie, because he was just... the biggest piece of shit ever. But his slave owner still had sort of like, you almost understood like his motivation. Like, not saying it's a good thing, but you understood like why he was doing it and how he was raised.
Brad Pitt won the Oscar for that. We're talking about how Brad Pitt doesn't have an Oscar, but he won for that.
Well,
for producer.
For producing, yeah. He wants that acting one.
Yeah.
But like, he was that. And then this year, same thing. When Steve Jobs came out, everyone was like, he has it in the bag. And then like, I feel like he's going to be next to it. And now there's already a movie next year he's doing with Alessio Vikander. Alicia, and it's a movie, I can't remember what it is, but they like, they watch this like lighthouse and they're completely alone and they find a kid on a boat and they adopt it, but then they find out like years later that they bump into the woman who's the kid actually belongs to, and Fassbender's like, we should give the kid back, and the mom's like, I'm not doing this. And so it's supposed to be really dramatic, and it's already like, looks like literally the trailer I saw posted with it was like Fassbender's like next Oscar potential thing. I'm like,
really?
Already? Like, it's 2016, like 2016, and we're all gonna screw him over like that. I feel like he gets a lot of hype in the beginning and then people forget about him. And
he needs a movie to come out in like December.
Yeah. And I don't think that says much about him as an actor. Like, I mean, that came out wrong, but I feel like people almost find him forgettable, where I feel like his performance, for me, I guess I'm biased, I really like him. I legitimately think he might be the greatest actor in this generation. I know it might be overhyped.
You know who he reminds me of is Gary Oldman.
Very much.
There's not a, like, and Gary Oldman is, I think, the epitome of a character
Only
actor.
One Oscar nomination for Gary
Oldman. Which is an absolute
career.
Shame.
Yeah.
But he never does a role that is similar. Whereas, like we're talking about this, like George Clooney, sometimes, like, yeah, he's a good actor, he's got some good movies, but he's definitely found his niche.
He appears
and
to
that's what he goes with. Leo, I also kind of find, is trying to, in his last couple movies, are playing to his strengths of being angry, so he can get that Oscar, get his anger
and show,
Oscar.
Like, a lot of different emotions between being upset and emotional
and
powerful.
And, you know, and broken. And, you know, so, but, like, I think, like, between Fassbender, he is just a true chameleon. And, like, I don't think it's that he's forgettable. I think it's that he is so natural on film that you kind of forget that he's like a movie star.
For
you
kind of
believe
nerds,
that he is.
Comic nerds will get this. Do you think, like, he's the Civil War of acting, and I mean in 2016 how we're all kind of excited for Civil War, but we're kind of like, oh yeah, we'll know we'll be good, and we kind of put that like, we're more excited for Deadpool, we're more excited for Batman. Yeah. Is Fassbender that, where it's like, oh yeah, he's always good, but what else is someone else doing? Like, because he's always good, people kind of know that, like, oh, I feel like he almost has a legal thing of, like, the Academy's being like, oh, we'll give him an award, like, eventually, and it's like, if I had my pick, I truthfully would want Michael Fassbender to win. I'm completely fine with Leo winning. I think he deserves it, but I think he should have won for a lot of other stuff. I think he should have won for Django. To me, that was, to me, it's still his best performance because he actually did something, a whole lot of difference. His performances are very similar. In Django, nothing different, or like totally different. And Christoph Waltz, great actor, but was doing the nice version of Inglourious Basterds. I hate to say that, but it was, it was Hans Landa, but as a good guy. And I felt like Leo was so much better. And so I wish then, he won for that.
Or The
and
Departed. Then, he was unreal in The Departed.
The only reason I'll say no for that is just because he had Damon and Nicholson taking the screen time as well, right?
So it that was is very, that is very true. That but was, I still think that does not undermine his role. If anything, that strengthens it.
Yeah, I agree. And what happened last year? How did you feel about last year? Or was it... Or the year... Whatever year it was when he didn't win over McConaughey. Did you agree with that? That was tough. I went back and forth. I'm fine with it that it happened, but...
You know, like, I'm all for the McConaissance.
Yeah. He's great, yeah.
I never would have thought Matthew McConaughey would have been a good actor. I will fully admit that. Mm-hmm. And I thought he was great. He won for the Dallas Buyers Club, did you not? Yeah. He's great. And he was great in that, but...
That was a year that was close, though. But it was, I wasn't mad that he won, but it was one of those, like... I still don't know in my heart who should have won that year.
Yeah,
like,
and I think Matthew McConaughey has got a lot of great performances ahead of himself, and I know obviously Leo does too.
Yeah.
So yeah, I'm not mad, but I don't know. I think is a weaker category though.
I agree. I think Eddie Redmayne's fine. Matt Damon is a really good performance, and Bryan Cranston is like, I haven't seen him, but I hear like he does a good job. But I feel like it's literally just. To those two. You're right. Eddie Redmayne could definitely sneak it out, but I think between all the marketing and the campaigning, I think this is Leo's year, and I think and that's why I'm fine with him winning. I think Fassbender... Watch my phone.
Oh, sorry.
I think Fassbender will get it again in the future. I just hope... I'm just, as a Fassbender fan, hoping he doesn't always get moved over because it's someone else's year, you know? And, like, I really feel like... Do you feel like Leto should have won for supporting?
No.
I feel like he was good, but I was thinking good for nominee, but not to win.
I mean, I know you really like Jared Leto. I think
I don't.
Oh, so you don't like Jared Leto?
No, I have nothing against him, but I don't. I'm kind of like, he's good, but I'm not like, I didn't want him to win an Oscar. I didn't want him to be the Joker. Like, I'm like, I'm not the biggest fan because I guess, and people love him in Fight Club. The other one people point to is Rec Room for a Dream, but I've never. Yeah, he's the blonde, he's bleach blonde, the guy that Edward Norton beats the shit out of, and he breaks all his teeth and everything. I can't remember his name.
Yeah.
And for me, Jared Leto, he's always a very good actor, but he never has blown me away. I think he might actually do that in Suicide Squad, to be honest. He's looking really good as a Joker. But in Dallas Buyers Club, I thought it was, once again, a really good performance for a nomination. But I like Leto enough, but I'm not in his fan club or anything like that.
I did not realize he was that old.
Yeah, he doesn't age. You talk about, we were talking about George Clooney doesn't age. He looks the same age. So I think I literally, for the person I want to win, I'm fine with both Fassbender and Leo. If Fassbender wins, I'm thrilled. If Leo wins, I'm really happy. Leo deserves it. Leo's definitely getting an award for kind of his whole career and whatnot. So I'm fine with that. So I would say that I would like Michael Fassbender or Leo to win, but I think Leo will win. And
Yeah, I don't disagree, and like, I mean, I'm not a big...
You're trying to find a picture of Jared Leto? I'm trying to find a picture of him,
because I honestly can't remember him.
Right there.
Okay, yeah. All right, I know.
But so, who do you want to win, and who do you think is going to win for the best actor?
I think Leo's going to win, and I want him to win.
Yeah.
I really like him this year. I really like Michael Fassbender, Steve Jobs. It's kind of like the same thing with Leo. I think he's done better roles that he should have won for.
Yeah.
But if he won for this, I wouldn't be mad by any means.
I think it's just those two. Anybody else.
I just really hope Eddie Redmayne doesn't win.
The thing is, he already won last year. He's cool.
I don't think.
You don't think he should have won last year?
I think he should have been nominated. I just don't think he should have won it. I thought there was better performances.
I agree 100% with that. I think Michael Keaton should have got it. Especially,
I really think he should
have. And it's one of these things that I hate. I don't know why the Oscars really is picky choosy. They never decide if they are... an award ceremony that is about the best picture or about the best story. And because we're going to see, sorry, a little spoiler, Stallone will probably win an Oscar. And because it's the best story of him coming back, playing Rocky, started his career, that's the best story. If we're writing the not Stallone...
Not his first Oscar, by the way.
What?
It's not his first Oscar.
What was his other one?
Rocky.
No, that's what I mean. No, but that's the story of the first Oscar. Yeah. If we're writing Stallone the movie, this is the perfect way to end it. Mm-hmm. And that's why I felt like last year, even though Michael Keaton was in Spotlight, I legitimately don't think Michael Keaton's going to get that many more nominations because they haven't really recognized him that much.
Yeah.
And I felt like I really want him to win it. And I agree. Eddie Redmayne was great, but I don't think it was... I personally did not think it was an amazing blowout performance. I left wilding the same thing as you, being like, total nomination, but a win...
Yeah.
Not so much.
I was so captivated by Michael Keaton's performance last year in Birdman. Actually, and all the actors in that did a phenomenal job.
Yeah. Okay, best performance by an actress in a leading role. Kate Blanchett for Carol. Charlotte Rampling, which is... I've not seen this movie, so I have no idea. 45 years. Brie Larson for Room.
Saoirse
Ronan for Brooklyn.
Say it fast enough, they won't know.
Saoirse Ronan for Brooklyn. And then Jennifer Lawrence for Joy.
Jennifer Lawrence did not have nominated.
I agree either, 100%. I think that's just the hype train of like...
We love J-Lo. Yeah. She's the greatest.
Carol, I saw... Good. Like, it's fine. Like, it's a very Oscar.
I didn't get around to seeing
it.
She
deserves a nomination for it, but it's nothing amazing. I feel like this is... Some people have brought up Ronan for Brooklyn, but I feel like this is a one-woman show. I feel like Brie Larson has... If I had to bet my life on one award, it would be her. She's won everything. She's been... Ever since Room came out, everyone was like, she has in the bag.
Yeah, I feel like... You know what? Like, I saw it. There was only a couple scenes, though, that really blew me away that I was like, ooh, this is great. And not to take away from performance at all, but I don't think it was overall that difficult at times. There were scenes where she needed, like, it was deep subject matter, and I thought she did great, but I thought there was other times where I was like, oh, it was okay. And I thought, to be honest, the kid stole the show for me.
Yeah, he should be nominated, which he's not.
Yeah, so I thought he did. Not that she was bad by any means, and if she wins, I wouldn't be mad, but I don't think it's... I think it's a nomination. I don't think it's a win.
I'm on the other perspective. I think it is an award-winning performance. It's definitely a nomination one, but it's one of these things, if there is better performances from... Saoirse Ronan, good job in Brooklyn, but I don't think that to me doesn't scream Oscar. Kate Blanchett was not Oscar joy, and like I said, I have not seen 45 years, but to me, if there was better performances that matched up with Brie Larson, I'd be like, okay, it's like the lead acting thing, right? Like, we think Leo should get it, but it's like, oh, if Fassbender got it, that'd be cool too. But right now, there's no one here that I'd be like, oh yeah, over Brie Larson. I'd be like, yeah, that makes sense. Right now, to me, Brie Larson is kind of like, maybe this year, kind of the big fish in the small pond. Like, if there's better... And that's not to take away from them all. They're all good, but I don't feel like there's any other standout leading actress. And I think it was still... I think she should still win an Oscar, to be honest. I think it was really good. I think I liked her more than you. There's a few more scenes, but I can see your point. So I would say I think Brie Larson will win. I want her to win. That's about it.
But you know what? I'm really excited for what she's going to do in the future, though. This got me excited for how her career is going to go.
I know some people be like, oh, of course you put her in this, but I 100%, and some people have thrown out there too, I want her as Captain Marvel, 100%. Take my money. They need a strong female actress that has a range and is going to carry a franchise. She's young.
She was so funny in 21 Jump Street, too.
I think you look at her and you think about her in Marvel, it'd be perfect. And she, to me, you could build a franchise off. Because Captain Marvel is going to be super important because that's going to be their Wonder Woman. That's going to be... Wonder Woman is there, like DC's ace in the hole. It's already built. But Miss Marvel, Captain Marvel, you don't know. So you need someone strong. And imagine Marvel going to throw up like Academy Award winner. And she's so young, she gets to win that award and she gets to cash in on it, you know?
Yeah.
Like I said, I want her to win and I think she will win. Are you pretty much in agreement? There's no one here that... say you would want to. That's what I mean. Like, she's the best out of this category.
That makes sense. I haven't seen 45 years, so...
Me either. And that's the thing.
Watch her be, like, the absolute best performance, and we're just totally, like, putting it to the side.
And that's the thing, too. Not even these movies. I can't think of any... Okay, there's only one movie where I would have been... I wanted a nomination, and I would have took... I would have took 45 years out because I hadn't seen her. I would have put Charlize Theron.
I was just going to say for Mad Max. As Furiosa, I thought
I wouldn't give her a win because I understand because it's not... She doesn't... Her performance is so strong, but she doesn't do too much. Like, I understand why it's not a win, but maybe in supporting actors.
Like, a very strong female character, but where I thought she won it is when they first go to the... with the mothers.
Yeah.
And she realizes that and the she green collapses place. In pain. Yeah, and she and the and like you have that beautiful shot of the wind blowing the sand around her. Yeah. And she just walks and drops, and you can tell like she just feels so defeated by everything. That was like that really and blew me away.
That was probably one of my biggest there's a lot of disappointments this year. Like I was really disappointed Strike Copton didn't get anything. I was really disappointed that Ryan Coogler didn't get anything for Creed. Have you seen Creed?
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, there's a lot, like, and obviously a lot of the people talk about, like, the Oscars so
white. Or even,
Which, I wish we should have got Kyle, so, you know, we weren't, in, you know, Rant, Rave, Repeat, so white right now.
No, who was... Quentin Tarantino. For screenplay.
Oh, yeah, I can see the... I said to, our secretary, the second they wrote that scene about Samuel Jackson and talking about that guy sucking his dick, I'm like, they lost it. Because, no, I'm fine with it, but I get the Academy, you know, was like, oh, that scene, that was over the line. Like, I don't need to see Samuel Jackson getting a blood. To me, that was like, oh, he went too far, which I don't care. The movie, I love the movie. Hateful Eight, to me, is, like, lots of people find it really controversy, but, like, I really liked it. So, yeah, we're...
All right, best performance by an actor in a supporting role.
I don't... Christian Bale, Big Short. Mark Rylance, Bridget Spice. Lots of people have been throwing support behind. Tom Hardy for Revenant. Sylvester Stallone for Creed. And Mark Ruffalo for Spotlight.
The one thing I will say about Tom Hardy is I hated him in that movie.
I like, loved him
in that movie. No, but I mean, like, as a character. Oh, yeah. I mean, like, I hated his character. I almost,
to be honest, thought he was better than Leo, to be honest.
Yeah, and I could see that. Like, there was a...
Tom Hardy's quality.
Yeah, there was points in it that I was like, oh. Like, I was like, I was... You know when you're watching a movie and you're getting really into it? And I was, like, actually getting, like, jazzed. I was like, I want to punch Tom Hardy in the face
and
right
Tom
now.
And Tom Hardy's so good at that. He's and you know who was originally supposed to do that? And I'd love to see the movie just for the parallel with Sean Penn. But filming happened. Yeah. And because Sean Penn's, like, really good friends with Alejandro. Mm-hmm. So it would have been really good to see. But I feel like Stallone has this in the bag.
I do as well.
I'm fine with him winning. Truthfully, if I had my pick, I would actually give it... If I... wanted to pick, I would give it to Tom Hardy, but I'm fine with Stallone. Mm-hmm. It was a great performance. To me, it's the best Rocky performance, and I'm not even a Rocky fan. Rocky, to me, is... People love that. I'm like, cool, it's Rocky. Like, I do not have the same love. Everybody else... I have seen Bridge Spice, so I can't say... People have said that is an option, too. He's gotten a lot of traction. Mark Ruffalo in Spotlight's just like... He does a good turn, but nothing that I'd say was award-worthy. And Christian Bale is same thing, good for a nomination, but I don't... And I love Christian Bale, but he does, like...
Yeah, you do like Christian Bale.
Yeah, but I don't think that was a... I can, like I said, when I like people, good for nomination, but I don't think that was a war winning performance. No. If Christian Bale won, I'd be like, cool, but that's really weird. Like, good performance, but not, he didn't have enough meat where both, I feel like Tom Hardy and Stallone. Stallone, obviously, like Rocky gets diagnosed with cancer.
I don't think Stallone gets enough credit in Hollywood for how talented he is.
No, as like he does a lot of shit movies.
He does do a lot of shit movies. But like, yeah, who cares? Yeah. He does it for the money, and he's having fun, whatever. Mm-hmm. But the first Rocky is awesome. Mm-hmm. The first Rambo is unreal. Filmed in Hope, by the way.
No.
Every time I go through Hope when I'm going to Vancouver, I always stop and just go, Rocky was filmed here.
Yeah,
David my dad Crusoe, always hopefully that. Died in the woods. But no, he came back for CSI Miami.
And I think it's good as, like, I honestly don't know if Stallone would ever get a Lifetime Achievement Award, but this would be it.
But
this is kind of like, it's one of those things, a bottom of the whole work. The same way as Al Pacino winning for Scent of a Woman of like, he shouldn't have won for that, but it's like thing of like, we never give it to him. He deserves it for the other performances we snubbed over. See, that's why I always worry about Fassbender. He's going to get it for some like Scent of a Woman movie. Yeah. I'll be like, oh no. But like, I feel like I'm fine with it. And that's what I mean. There's times where I'm fine with this kind of storybook ending, you know, and that's what Stallone won them. You'll never see Stallone back nominated. I would put money on that. You'll never see him nominated for anything again. Wouldn't you agree?
No.
I feel like this is the only time to give him an Oscar.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or like award. I don't mean give him, but like, there, like
oh, we said, no, he's definitely earned it.
Yeah,
but like,
I think so.
I think it'd just be a nice feather in the cap.
Yeah.
Right, why don't we go to next? Actress in a supporting role?
I would want Tom Hardy to win, but Stallone. I'm fine with Stallone.
I want Stallone to
and
win,
I think
too.
He will win, too. I think it fits the ending. Best performance by an actress in a supporting role, Jennifer Jason Leigh in Hateful Eight, Alicia Vikander and Danish Girl, Rooney Mara and Carol, Kate Winslet, Steve Jobs, Rachel McAdams, Spotlight.
Just before, so Rooney Mara and Kate Mara, do you know who they're... parents are?
No.
So on the mom side, they own the Steelers, and on the dad side, they own the New York Jets.
That's funny. Wow.
Yeah, so...
It's a lot of money.
And, like, and now, not to take away from their acting, because they are both great actors, but sometimes you almost wonder if, like, oh, hey, so you had the funds to actually pursue an acting career. or and didn't have to worry about that.
But I don't fault them for that. If I got lucky, and had millions of dollars, if my kids wanted to like go into acting and get like professionally trained, I'd give them the money. Like, I think to me, if you have money, you use it. You know,
which, without a doubt,
it's but not going to get her an Oscar. Which I'll say, it's a good enough. It's a good performance. She's a great actress. I wish she did. I don't know what I wish she did. Carol's good enough. I just wish there was something. Girl Dragon Tattoo. Like, I'm waiting for another. I think she will win an Oscar in her career. I think she actually is really good.
I
don't
think Kate will, but I think she could win an Emmy. Will. Yeah, I can see that.
But I think Rooney, she's probably one of the best actresses today. I think she's very underrated. I think because I almost feel like it's the Fassbender thing that she's usually always good. Like, we talked about Offcast, about how terrible the Nightmare on Elm Street remake was. Mm-hmm. But she's, like, decent in this horrible, horrible film. Like, I feel like she's Fassbender where people almost kind of forget. But she won't win here. I didn't see anything amazing from her.
The one thing that I will say is Alicia Vikander got nominated for The Danish Girl, mm-hmm. which I'm all for. But I almost think it's a shame she didn't get nominated for Ex Machina.
If she wins, I think it'll be because both of them.
Because Ex Machina was so good, and I wish it would have gotten more nominations. Have you seen that one yet?
Yeah, I did, because you told me to see it.
You liked it, right?
I love it.
It's one of my favorite movies of the year, without a doubt.
I agree.
And I'm a little choked that it didn't get more nominations, because even at the end of that movie, it was kind of like when I saw Gone Girl, I didn't feel good with myself after it.
Sucks.
Because I was like, and it was such a good story, so well acted, and like everything in it, and like it was.
I feel like that's why she could win, because in Danish Girl, did you see Danish Girl?
No, I haven't seen that.
Okay, she steals it from Eddie Redmayne. She's actually better than him, and he's doing the whole like transformation, but she steals it. She just brings like big weight and emotion in the performance. She's talking about actresses to look out for. Like, she's gonna like. Look out for her. She's going to be doing... You're going to see her in this type of nominations probably every second year. Like, anytime she's in a movie, you're going to see her in this
I concur. I think she's going to be a big deal.
And that's why I think if she wins, it's kind of for both. Because I think the thing with Ex Machina is maybe the Oscars were kind of like, we never nominated Andy Serkis for Gollum. We kind of stay away from the CGI. I think let's get for Danish Girl. But if we might vote for her, she's great in Danish Girl and Ex Machina. It's kind of like with the Razzies, how they'll give someone a Razzie, but it's always for like multiple movies. Like Adam Sandler was like, oh, Pixels and Jack and Jill or something like that. It's like, okay. So I feel like she could win, but the big wild card here is Kate Winslet, because she has won. She won a Globe. She's won a bunch of awards, and I don't know why. How do you feel about her in Steve Jobs? I feel like it's good, nomination good, but I never walked away and be like, man, she's the one that deserves an Oscar out of this film.
I don't know. I've never really got the Kate Winslet hype. It's like, she's really good at everything I've seen. Phenomenal. But like, I don't think I've ever seen her in anything that's made me go, wow.
Little Children, isn't that what she won for?
Oh, it could be. I couldn't tell you. Okay, so what do you think about The Hateful Eight with Jennifer Jason Leigh?
I actually thought she was going to take it when I saw the movie. That was my initial pick. And then I don't know who my I don't really necessarily have a pick who I want to win. I think this sounds bad, but I almost, not that I don't want Kate Winslet to win, but I'd rather someone else win because she has an Oscar.
Yeah.
It's other girls, like other women, sorry, like kicking off their career. Jennifer Jason Leigh was great in The Hateful Eight. She's kind of having like a career renaissance. But it's because it's kind of a dirty performance that they might steer away from it. I feel like she had a lot of traction and it just kind of went away. It was kind of like, oh, she's great, and then just kind of like just dropped off. Yeah. So I would feel like it's... And Rachel McAdams is just there because it's like good enough performance, but in Spotlight, not memorable at all. I'm sorry. I love Rachel McAdams. She was one of my first crushes, like celebrity crushes.
Do love a good girl, Canadian girl.
Yeah, I wanted her to be Catwoman so badly, and that means a lot because Catwoman's my all-time fictional crush. So anybody I want to be Catwoman, that's Rooney Mara. There you go. No, Ben Affleck, she's too young. But well, you tried to pitch fucking Daisy Ridley on a podcast. We didn't get
phenomenal.
To do. We're going to do that one again. But so I think it's between these two. Truthfully, I want Alicia Vikander to win.
Yeah, I do as well. I think she's phenomenal.
Gut will say Winslet.
Yeah, I think it's going to be Alicia Vikander. I think she's going to take it.
You think you
want her? I want her to win, and I hope she wins.
Okay.
Let's go directing.
Best achievement.
Directing is an incredible category.
Yeah.
Adam fucking McKay.
Good for him.
Anchorman.
Step Brothers.
Is now at least an Oscar-nominated director.
Yeah.
Which so, I think, that's just a phenomenal
Adam
story.
McKay for The Big Short. Lenny Abramson, right?
Abramson
for The Room. So he was nominated. Good. I didn't know that earlier. George Miller for Mad Max Fury Road, Tom McCarthy for Spotlight, and then Alejandro in New Week 2. I'm not saying his middle name because...
Gonzalez.
Gonzalez, thank you. Why did I not have Bruno? I thought it was something...
I could say in your redo, but you can't say Gonzalez.
I'm not that good with just, like, English, like, my own language. Like, I'm really... which is not good because I want to be a writer. That's why I have, like, really good people that edit my scripts. But, like, I'm like... I'll admit, I'm not... I'm definitely no smart guy. I 100% want George Miller to get this.
I want George Miller to win. I think Alejandro's going to take it.
I know, but, like, I think it's only between these two. Adam McKay, I think it's a great kind of, like, debut of, like, a nomination. Yeah. Thanks for changing up, but I don't think so.
No, I don't think so as well.
It was good, but not good enough. And not stronger than, to me, George Miller and Alejandro. And then third, I'd put Lenny.
I wouldn't.
I would because how he directed the kid. And he got that performance out of a kid actor.
You know what? That's actually, like, a decent point.
Yeah.
But I think it's between George Miller and Alejandro and Eureka.
I don't think he has a shot at all.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
I'm just saying,
I misunderstood.
Yeah, I'm just saying, like, I don't see Tom McCarthy for Spotlight or Adam McKay at all.
No,
like,
not at all. It,
they're just simple, not simple movies, but they are simpler plots where Lenny was hard, but I feel like, yeah, you take him out. I feel like it's 100% between George Miller
and Alejandro. I want George Miller to win, but I think Alejandro's going to take it. The Academy loves him.
They do, but the good thing is what they've seen. For a while, I can't remember what year it was, but for a while it was like only 4 times that Best Picture and Best Director had not been the same person. But the past few years, it's been changing a lot. Like, you look at Argo. Ben Affleck did not win Best Director.
Which is an absolute shame.
It's a big crime. We'll get into that later when we talk about, like, crimes of the Oscars. And then the other one was for... What won over Gravity for Best Picture? Because remember, they gave it to Alfonso Cuarón for directing, but something else won Best Picture.
Yeah,
And that's what I mean. It's more of a trend this year, and I'm hoping... This is why I hope that the voters go, you know what? Alejandro won last year. George Miller, very much like the Stallone thing, might not be back here. I think everyone's taking this Mad Max as like, oh, it's a change of guard. I hope so, but I guarantee the next Mad Max will not get a nomination. I feel like they did that because there's just been such an uproar in the film community of like, hey, this film's fucking amazing, and like, you should recognize it. And I'm so glad it is. Day it was nominated, I was so happy because I've been through that with before. I'll get into it later. The Dark Knight. That was my last film. Like, this needs to be nominated because not only is it a great film, but I just feel like it's inspiring people and it's inspiring a change in the film genre.
You know what's funny? Like, I love The Dark Knight.
Yeah.
It has definitely had more of an impact on you than I would say it is me. But you talk to anybody and you say, what is the best, like, superhero film? Dark Knight. No matter what, that is everybody's go-to answer. And it's for a reason. It's a great film.
And I'm not saying, I know Dark Knight, I'm almost fine with it not winning Best Picture, but I just want it nominated to give it that.
Yeah.
This is an Academy Award, and that's why there is fucking 10 nominations now. But it's Academy. Yeah. So I'm already happy with Mad Max, but I know I'm pretty set that Mad Max will not win Best Picture. I've decided, you know what, that's not my heel to die on, but George Miller, I feel like, has a good shot at this and deserves it. That fucking movie, they talk about The Revenant being so hard, Mad Max took forever. And you look at that movie, there's no way that was an easy movie to shoot. So it's the whole thing of like, oh yeah, Revenant was hard to shoot. Yeah, it fucking was. Same as Mad Max, like, to me, the way you look at it. So I think it's between these two. I want George Miller. I agree with you. I think it will be Alejandro, but I think there's still a chance for an upset. If that envelope... Yeah. Opens with George Miller, I'll be so happy. He deserves it. It's the same thing as like...
Also, by the way, I'm not watching it live, so if you text me the results, I'm going to be so mad at you.
I might not be either. I know. We're doing an Oscar cast. We might not have to. Yeah, my dad's getting surgery, so I got to be there, help him recover. I'll be watching it either late Sunday night or Monday in the morning. So
I'm probably going to do Monday morning because I have training that night.
So. Yeah, so I'll be off Twitter the whole time unless I'm watching it live. But yeah, so you're the same as me. Want George Miller, think Alejandro.
Yeah,
but I definitely do. Out of all the categories we've been on so far, I think this is one of the most toss-up ones. Most of them, it's gonna Leo's gonna take it. Best Picture, we kind of know, like, it's probably gonna be Revenant.
Yeah,
with a few, it's just this,
like, yeah,
you can easily see them being like, you know what, let's give it to George because like I don't think he'll be back there again. And like, yeah, best writing, screenplay, written directly from the screen,
no question.
Bridge
of Spies, Spotlight, Straight Outta Compton, Inside Out, and Ex Machina were nominated. It's funny, because we're looking at the list, so we don't forget anything. But without a doubt, Ex Machina. I wouldn't be mad if Inside Out won, actually. Because Inside Out really got me in the feels.
Do you feel like Straight Outta Compton maybe wins to give it...
No, I...
You feel like they don't do it because of the controversy, and they're like... hey, you know what we should do? We should get Straight Outta Compton that award because they've done that before. And they've done that reverse of like, oh yeah, Brokeback Mountain, gay cowboy movie. You're not going to win a Best Picture.
Yeah.
Like, but you should. Like,
honestly, Brokeback Mountain, like I saw that this year. I'd never seen it prior.
You've never seen it?
It's I just saw it this year. And I was blown away.
It's amazing.
That is, it is so well directed. It's, it is so well done. That was just a good film. But no, I think Ex Machina should win. I also like that's the only one that was written by one person as well.
Yeah, but Inside Out. I'm fine. I think that's tough because Spotlight could win though. Because if they don't give it Best Picture, they might want to be like, oh hey, here's your thing.
Well, okay,
I think anyone here legitimately could win except for Bridge of Spies. I think Straight Compton is the hey kill the controversy. Ex Machina, Inside Out because they're so different. Spotlight because it's what Oscar likes. I think Bridge of Spies no just because I've not heard enough. So I think I'm not really. I guess I'd pull. I'm agree with you. I'd throw my weight behind Ex Machina for who I think, but. Or, I mean, who I want, but who I think, I have no idea. I think it could be any one of those four.
The one thing that I will say in defense of Inside Out and Ex Machina, Bridge of Spies is based on a true story, or at least true events. So is Spotlight, so is Straight Outta Compton.
Yeah.
It's a lot easier to write a compelling story when the facts are already there, whereas Inside Out and Ex Machina are taking something, they may borrow some aspects of it from various things, but they're both original concepts that the other three are not. They're unique. And I think, without a doubt, they're just better written films than the other three.
Yeah. No, I agree. So you're wanting
I want Ex Machina.
Who do you think?
Oof.
I think it's...
Honestly, I could see going Straight Outta Compton or Spotlight, but I really want Ex Machina to win. Yeah.
So we're kind of undecided on that one, because writing screenplay best on material previously published or producer-published, sorry. So, best adapted screenplay. This one's tough, too. Sorry, The Big Short.
So long.
The Martian. Yeah, they should just say best adapted screenplay. The Big Short, The Martian, Brooklyn, Room, and Carol. I feel like take Carol and Brooklyn out.
I'd say The Martian, because I really, really like that book. So, I'd probably give it to that one, to be honest.
For me, it's between... Not for who I want, but who I think. And I think... It's between The Room and Big Short, to be honest. I think The Martian's going to come away as a big loser in this one. I don't think it's going to get many awards. I think if Mad Max wasn't here, Martian would have a better chance. But I feel like because they already have those two like technical films almost. Yeah. So I don't... For who I want, I don't really have anybody in particular I want. I like The Big Short. I really like The Martian. I really like Room. So I'm kind of fine with The Martian or Room. But if I had to throw my weight behind who I think, I'll... go with The Big Short. I don't know why. I just have some feeling about like The Big Short being like, I don't know, because Room, like you said, there might be some people that feel like maybe there's some stuff missing, but Big Short, I feel like it did a good job of putting it on screen, which to me would be a hard book just for me in the movie. So I'm thinking Big Short, and you're thinking
I'm thinking The Martian. That's what I think is going to be.
Yeah. Best animated film, Animasala, which I really want to see. People say is good. Shaun the Sheep, the movie. Omena, I don't know, and then Omena, Omani, and then Inside Out. We know what's gonna win this.
Inside Out.
Yeah, Pixar.
If Inside Out doesn't win, I'm gonna be really pissed off.
Inside Out is great, and it just, Pixar usually cleans up here, like Toy Story 3, this, like Ratatouille, like when Pixar is slapped on there, it's done. I think these last ones we're probably not gonna know much about.
Yeah, best foreign language film.
I don't watch that many.
I've never heard of any of them. So
here we go. So sorry if you want someone else to. We're not full.
I'm gonna put my money behind.
You want to guess on one?
Sure. Just take a guess. Just basing on the images that we have, so the poster.
And the names.
I'm gonna go Krigan. Cregan.
I'll go Sophia because it's looking really intense. Sophia. Could be like a war drama.
Okay, yeah.
Okay,
all right.
There we go. That's the only one I'll text you about. Like, look who won!
Yeah, because I won't care.
So,
best achievement at cinematography. Now, this is an interesting one.
I'm thinking Revenant. I want Mad Max.
So, Carol the Revenant, Sicario, The Hateful Eight, and Mad Max are nominated.
Mm-hmm.
I know. If Mad Max won, I would be more than happy. I think The Revenant, for the way they used natural light and the way they use those big wide panning shots, I think that one deserves to win. That's the one that I want to put my
only thing
behind.
Is Emmanuel Lubezki has already won two Oscars. That's why I want Mad Max. He won it for Gravity, and he won it for, what was last year, Birdman.
Yeah.
So it's one of these things of like, yeah, I guess three Oscars is great, but give it to I think Mad Max cinematography is great, so I'm the same.
Yeah, oh, no, I think it's great too, but I to me, I think The Revenant was
a movie just, painting.
It really was. Yeah. I think there was a lot of scenes in Mad Max that blew me away, and I think it should
win. To me, Revenant is like the movie painting where Mad Max is like the difficult math problem of like, how did they do this? Like, this is so crazy that they did this. Like, it's very two different. They're both great, but very two different.
And it took a lifeless, area and made it so vibrant and unique. But the Revenant.
So did the Revenant almost.
But the Revenant is so beautiful.
Yeah.
And like it was just so stark in contrast with everything that was happening. And I just think I think that one was one of the most beautiful films I've ever seen.
No, I'd agree. So I'm wanting Mad Max and I'm thinking the Revenant. That seems to be a two, like, that's the thing. Revenant to me is
13 nominations each. Yeah, so that's probably gonna happen a lot.
Yeah, and to me that's the thing. Like, I'm picking Mad Max over Lost stuff. That's because I like Mad Max a little more, but the Revenant I actually really like. There's a lot of people that think it's kind of boring or slow. I can definitely see that. It definitely is slower, but I just really like same way as you. It's just like kind of a visual smorgasbord. You know?
Yeah,
like,
it really is.
Best achievement in editing: The Big Short, Spotlight, Mad Max, Star Wars, and Revenant. This one I actually want Mad Max, and I think
I'm not gonna
lie,
I don't really understand this category.
Best edit, so it's just like editing the scenes together and whatnot. I think
Mad Max as well, but I don't know. I don't know enough about this category to be honest.
Like, then I will say I think Mad Max, and I want Mad Max. I think because the intensity it goes, I think with the Revenant, it's very well edited. It's just I feel like Mad Max would have had a tougher time with.
If
the
it
content,
wasn't, yeah,
like I feel like that's a lot of stuff that could just be a pain. Yeah.
Like, I'm just to clarify, I understand what editing is,
yeah,
but like, I find like that's a very vague category. Yeah, like, what are your criteria for that?
Yeah, and that's where I would feel. That's why I'd give it over Mad Max
same with the next one, production design.
Yeah, same. But I'd give it Mad Max because I feel like the editing. Some people would say, "Oh, Revenant is a little slow," and I feel like that could be an editing job of like, you know what, not to make the pace too slow or whatnot, so
and to keep it balls to the wall like they truly did.
Yeah, best production design, I think that's just like, that's
so
just
Bridge of Spies, The Martian, Danish Girl, Revenant, and Mad Max. I give it to Mad Max, to be honest, like especially like the cars, I mean them and themselves were so unique, but
I would for that too, because
the Citadel,
what,
where it was like, yeah, that is so well done,
and especially because the Revenant, definitely there's some production there, but they are using real stuff, right? Like, they made a big deal about
in Canada.
Yeah, they made a big deal about like, oh, we filmed outside, blah blah blah. But it's like, yeah, to me that's not so much design, it's just like a good idea where Mad Max, you literally had to make that stuff from
scratch. Yeah. And you had to make a livable world out of a lifeless desert.
So I think Mad Max, and you know what, I want Mad Max, but I actually think it will win too.
Yeah, no, I do as well. I'm all for Mad Max.
Turning
on
into
that
the Mad Max podcast.
Best achievement in costume design. So we got Carol, Mad Max, The Revenant, Cinderella, and The Danish Girl.
I think Cinderella, because it's Mad Max is good, but there's not enough costumes. I feel it's a lot of naked dudes or like half naked dudes.
But I think that's also part of the costume and how you have how the hedgehogs, I think they were called, had their own unique look. How everybody in the Citadel had their own unique look. To how the mothers had their own unique look. I think it was very unique. And we're talking about this off-cast. I am not a big fan of Peter Jackson's The Hobbit films. However, I feel they got snubbed in costume design every single year that it was nominated. For example, like with Carol and the Danish Girl, I understand that their costumes were nice in this, but they're kind of, they can use, like it's a period piece almost, so yeah. Like they have something to go off of. Whereas with Mad Max and even Cinderella, you're kind of censored a little less, but what I really want to stress with like The Hobbit and Mad Max is they're creating something from scratch. They're creating their own unique world that could like sink or swim on how they look. Like, did you ever watch the original Star Trek series?
No.
Like, you watch it, and a lot of times they're using like bathroom rugs for like capes and stuff, and like it shows, and it kind of takes you out. But like when you look back at it now, it's kind of fun. But
yeah,
if you know, in Mad Max, if they were just wearing like really cheap jeans, like you would be like, oh, okay, like I don't know, I'm not into this world as much. And so the fact that it is so unique, and you know what the War Boys look like, and you know what Immortan Joe's costume's incredible in that. And the guy that ran the bullet farm, and like everything in it is so well done and so unique that even in the fact that they're all wearing rags and it's all, you know, makeshift everything, they're all unique and you know who they are by just looking at them.
And I feel like you using your Hobbit examples why Cinderella will win, because I feel like they'll look at the big nice dresses, and it is a lot of quantity. They like to go like a lot of people.
No,
said
and
that
that's
like
why I think Cinderella
wouldn't.
Yeah, I think Cinderella would deserve to win for that.
I'd want Mad Max because I love the design, but I'm kind of fine with Cinderella winning. I feel like Mad Max is going to win a lot more, and it's good for Cinderella to win one. I've actually seen Cinderella, and I actually kind of really like it. It's like
a really... Snow White and the Huntsman won over The Hobbit one year.
Oh, see, so...
And, like, that's terrible.
I think Cinderella has this in the bag.
Yeah.
Best achievement for makeup and hairstyling. You want to say that first one there, William?
Holy shit. Han Dragon som klev ut genom fönstret och frost van.
So Die Hard 6. No.
So it is what appears to be a Dutch film, possibly Swedish. I don't really know many Northern Hungarian? European languages. No, it's not Hungarian.
No.
Okay. The Revenant and Mad Max Fury Road. Without a doubt, Mad Max Fury Road.
I could see that going for Revenant.
That being said, I'm actually surprised. About
Leo and all the beards and all the, like, you know, it was like, it was his... Well, no, it's still hairstyling. Like, I feel like anything about Leo with his really chapped lips, and it's funny because Mad Max has that too.
Yeah.
But they show Leo's progression throughout the movie through almost his look. So I could see... I don't actually care between Remnant and Mad Max, because I could see both.
I'm Mad actually Max. Surprised Star Wars didn't get nominated for this, because I would have given that to them.
Yes and no. I feel like it's good they didn't see the practical, but I didn't see enough practical, to be honest.
Once again, that's another thing The Hobbit got snubbed for.
Yeah. Like, so... I'm kind of fine, like, who I want to win, I'm kind of fine with both Mad Max or Revenant. I could see Mad Max definitely has a bit different, but I feel like Revenant did a good job of telling the story through the look, but I could see it going either way. I don't know the other film at all. I'm sorry. What is this? Oh, a 100-year-old man and something. I don't know, but I've not seen another film. I can't. I feel like that's just put in there. It's like, oh, yeah, this really nice film, foreign film. We'll get to that, so.
Best achievement in music written for motion pictures, original score. Star Wars, Hateful Eight, Carol, Bridge of Spies, Sicario. To be honest, none of those actually stand out to me.
Hateful Eight does. I think Hateful Eight will take it. Hateful Eight's really good. It's just like this really ominous tone, and it really stands out. It just really sets the mood, and it's almost something I've never heard before. Yeah, none of these to me really
stand out. I think Star Wars kind of let me down a little bit.
I think Star Wars,
with the exception of Ray's theme, there's nothing really new.
There's a couple tracks in there I actually do like, but not enough where I was like, oh yeah, it's an Oscar tenor. I think that was just more in the fact of, like, he's back. Like, John Williams back doing what he is good at, so.
Yeah, so, I'll go with you, and I'll say The Hateful Eight. Next is the category that we've... think is just awful, is the best achievement in music written for the motion picture. So the best original song. So we have Racing Extraction from Manta Ray.
I think this is one of the worst categories.
Yeah, I've ever Youth seen. Simple Song, The Hunting Ground, It Will Happen to You, Lady Gaga, Deanne Warren, 50 Shades of Grey, Earned It by the Weeknd, Spectre, Writing on the Wall, which is easily the worst Bond song ever. And whoa. I love Sam Smith, but that is not a great song.
I'll disagree. I actually like Writing on the Wall. I think it's in the middle of the Bond songs. I don't think what you just said is one of the worst. I think it's good, but he won a Golden Globe. I will pick that because I don't know who else to pick here. I do not think Earned It is a fucking Academy Award.
Now, song. I really like that song, and I'm pumped that The Weeknd got nominated. But there's the fact that 50 Shades of Grey is now an Oscar-nominated movie, I think, is the biggest crime. And for that reason alone, they shouldn't have nominated
it. If this category does not change, like, this next year, like, because I feel like original songs are dying. If next year it's, again, like this, where it's like there's a bunch of films that have no really good songs, I want this category gone. It's like a waste of time. It does. I hope they don't. This is one of the years. I hate some years they're like, oh, we're going to perform every song on stage, and some years they don't. I hope this is the year they don't, because I don't really want to see any of these songs.
No, but not at all.
Best achievement in sound mixing. Bridge of Spies, Revenant, Mad Max Fury Road, Star Wars, and The Martian.
I think Star Wars.
It could.
I think that the sound design in Star Wars and the mixing, and like, that really blew me away. Same thing as
what you talk about other stuff. The other movies have something based on Mad Max as a car to base sounds off of, like, and that's more sound editing, where I think Mad Max will win, but sound mixing is when you're creating your own sound. So
yeah, and that's like Star Wars. I think without a doubt.
Yeah.
Okay. So now, as you said, best 2 minute sound editing. So yeah. Sicario, Martian, Revenant, Star Wars, and Mad Max.
Yeah.
I'd probably give it to Mad Max.
I think so. I think the car, like, just the car sounds and the like, kind of the violence and just all the the noise, there's so much noise in Mad Max, but it never comes off as a noisy film, and that to me is the perfect, that's why I love that film. Like, it's the perfect mix of the cars and the score and everything and the like bass that. Guy. I know the score doesn't have to, yeah, and the score doesn't have much to do with it, but I feel like Revenant to me, I don't want to say it's easy sound edit, but there's times where he's just walking in the snow
and it's just
like,
quiet.
Yeah, it's like, okay, cool. But
and it paints a really beautiful picture, like we said prior, but like it's not, I don't know, it didn't blow me away, whereas Mad Max truly did.
Yeah.
Next one, my favorite category, is the best achievement of visual effects. The Martian, Mad Max, Ex Machina, The Revenant, and Star Wars. If any one of these films won it, I would not be mad. I think every one of them was phenomenal.
Yeah.
But Star Wars didn't blow me away with their special effects. Not that it was bad by any means. I thought it was great. But I thought Ex Machina had a really strong use of it. With Alicia Vikander when she was the... the AI, and they're testing it. And, like, there's times where you honestly don't know what's real, what's not. And there's a couple scenes where he's, like, peeling her skin off.
Yeah, that was really good. I forgot about those scenes.
And, yeah, and it's... And it, more so than, like, with Star Wars or Mad Max or even The Martian, where you're like, okay, like, I know this is not real. Whereas that one, it was just blended so well with what was real.
Yeah.
I would love if that one, that's... But I think it's going to be Star Wars or Mad Max is going to win for this one. The Revenant, I don't think there was really enough like visual effects to really make it. The Martian.
Beautiful film, too.
Yeah, not something that I would slight in any way, but I think it's going to be Mad Max or Star Wars. And even Mad Max alone for that hurricane scene, like that sandstorm scene.
Yeah. It's kind of the same thing as you. I feel like one. This is one of those categories that's really up in the air. It could really go anywhere. Yeah. I could still see them giving it.
And that's why it's my favorite, because it's always really good competition.
I'd say I'd want to give it to everyone but The Revenant. And I guess it's kind of a theme in here. But it's one of these things like if I'm planning the Oscars, it's winning Best Picture. So to me, I feel like that's why I can lose some of the smaller awards.
And correct me if I'm wrong. In The Revenant, it was just a bear, right?
That's why it's getting that nomination, and I can see it winning for that because it is such a good scene. Like you do almost feel like that bear is real. Like it's really.
But besides that, I mean,
the horse not really... falling and stuff.
Okay,
like that.
Oh yeah, I guess there's a couple more.
Yeah, so I'm fine. You know what? Actually, I'm fine with Revenant winning. So I'm fine with any of them winning, and who I think I'll give it to Star Wars because I feel like they're gonna want
to
give it.
I'd give it to Mad Max, but I really want Ex Machina to win for that.
Yeah. So what's one of the last ones?
Best documentary.
I've not seen any of these. I really want to, I've seen one.
I've seen Amy.
Yeah, and I'll throw my weight behind Amy. Not even because that's the only one I've seen. I think it's really, really good. I have not seen that one, so I can't compare it. I guess I'm just hoping it wins because I really enjoyed Amy. It's really good. It's very sad, and yeah.
I've seen bits of Winter on Fire in a couple classes, but nothing. I couldn't throw my opinion behind it.
I guess what are the nominees?
Amy. Obviously the story of Amy Winehouse. What Happened, Miss Simone. Winter on Fire, Ukraine's Fight for Freedom, Cartel Land, and The Look of Silence. I don't really even know much about all of them, to be honest, with the exception of like the Ukraine one. Amy's the only one I've seen, and that's the one I'd like to win because I've seen it really. So, but you know what? I also haven't really heard much about these documentaries. Like, do you remember when Blackfish came out? And everybody's talking about Blackfish. Also, if you haven't seen Blackfish, I highly recommend watching it. But there's a couple that come along that, even though they're documentaries, I really am, you know, it's really compelling. And but this year, I didn't really, you know, notice any of them. But
yeah, for all the rest of these, I don't have much to add. They're all
best documentary short subject. I don't know.
And that someone's like, you need to watch this
short film. I don't know. I'd like the bear story to win. I just really
so
like
those are the only three categories we'll kind of like
and technical achievements no
yeah but those are just people getting awards, they're not nominated, like they're gonna get them. So those are our picks for the 2016 nominations. So yeah, let me know or let the Geekverse know what you think if you're watching them and what you think's gonna win, and then those are our picks. And yeah, now we're going to our main, like, I guess our second main topic was when we were talking about we want Mad Max to win but we think Revenant will probably win. We're going to go down what we said earlier, films that we thought should have won, or maybe kind of a question. And I'm starting at 1995 because, one, I thought about, that's the time where I feel like I was looking through a list that we've probably seen the most films as far as, compare, like, a lot of older movies I've seen, but I haven't seen every one. I've seen a lot of the great ones.
Or Weddings and a Funeral got nominated?
So, anyways, we're starting at 1995 because I thought, This is the one that I always hear the most, and it's about Forrest Gump winning over certain movies. So the winner of the Best Picture was Forrest Gump, nominated against Four Weddings and a Funeral, Pulp Fiction, Quiz Show, and Shawshank Redemption. I think I have to agree with everybody, especially with like Shawshank. We talked a little bit off cast. I don't love as much as anybody else, like everybody else. Also, think that's like the greatest movie of all time. I think it's very well made. It's very good, but I would still see that winning over Forrest Gump. But the main one is Pulp Fiction, and it always one of these things because you kind of know Tarantino's not going to win for anything else, right? Like it's kind of. That's kind of it. Like, they kind of give him that screenplay nod, but that's about it now. Like, they don't really get, like, I don't even know if Django, and I guess maybe Django was nominated for Best Picture, but they never sound like, you never hear they're going to win, like, Bastards.
Yeah, no, without it, and, like, I think of all of his movies, I think Pulp Fiction is probably the one that is his best, or at least my favorite.
I think 100% is the best.
Yeah, and like, I don't know, I love Forrest Gump. I like it more than Shawshank, but I do think Pulp Fiction should have won. Four Weddings and a Funeral, I'm actually surprised was nominated. I really like that film, but
yeah, none of these other ones. So where is my phone? I'm going to be keeping tally at the end of what, if we thought that, if they got it right more than wrong. So,
and we're just going to do Best Pictures, correct?
Yeah. No, not the whole cast. Yeah. No.
This would be a long podcast.
Yeah, because I think the actor one, you get more room because actors will be nominated again and they get much more chances than like a film or a director.
Yeah, and, they do and, a it's, lot and it's more. Very subjective to the time and who people are really liking.
Yeah.
So.
Okay, so one wrong. So yeah, go to 68 right there.
Oh, perfect. Oh, this is weird. No. I'm.
What did you do?
I'm so
to
used
my laptop.
Well, I'm not used to a laptop. Porn I'm virus. Fast. I'm used, yeah, there we go. Eh? I'm so used to my computer.
Okay, no. So Braveheart won in 1996 over Apollo 13, Babe, directed by George Miller, El Pastor and the Postman, and Sense and Sensibility. I think I'm fine with these. I've actually not seen the Postman, so
that's a great film.
I've not seen it.
Yeah, it's really good.
That's why, as you see, I can.
Babe, I'm surprised you got nominated. For
I actually
picture.
Am too, but it's a good movie. But I'm just surprised.
It's a great film. I love Apollo 13, but Braveheart is something else.
Yeah,
it is truly a wonderful, wonderful film. Historically accurate, it is not, but it is. It's really good. So I'd say the Academy got it right on that one.
Yeah. No, I'm fine with that.
All right, 97. Which we got. Okay, Best Picture.
English Patient, Fargo, Jerry Maguire, Secret and Lies, Shine, and The English Patient won. I think I'll find that. The only one I could have seen is Fargo.
I'd say Fargo. The English Patient boring.
I think Fargo's definitely more enjoyable. Yeah,
I think Fargo's a better movie than The English Patient. I truly, truly do.
You know, I'll agree as far as what I like. I think they probably like The English Patient is more of an Oscar-like movie.
Yeah.
So I could see them doing that, but I still feel...
When was the last time you heard anybody talk about The English Patient?
Right now.
Well, yeah. All right, fair enough. You played yourself. Thanks, DJ Khaled.
There we go.
But no, I think Fargo much more stands the test of time.
Yeah, I'll agree with that. Titanic, As Good As It Gets, The Full Monty... Good Will Hunting and L.A. Confidential. L.A. Confidential, good job getting the nomination. This one's tough for me, because I'm going to say it's right, because I can see why they nominated it. Yeah. I can see why they won it. Titanic, for me, is not... I can see why it's a great film. It's not anything for me. I don't love it. Yeah. It's
I love
there.
The Full Monty. That's what I think that... Have you seen The Full Monty?
I don't... Who's in it?
I was the guy that was in 28 Days Later. Or, sorry, 28 Weeks Later. He was in Once Upon a Time, too. Robert Carlyle. Thank you. Mm. It's it's so
British
funny.
British comedy, wow.
And they become strippers.
I've
and
never
all
seen
it's
that.
Just, it's a really good film.
But do you agree, even though Titanic's not
I think
because
Titanic was a spectacle.
Yeah.
Which is what James Cameron does best. The Full Monty, I wouldn't have given... I love it. I wouldn't have given it the best picture. Yeah. Good Will Hunting, I might have. But
as a win or
as a win,
yeah,
because I like Good Will Hunting over
they
Titanic.
They did win
but...
a lot. Yeah, me too. I would like for me my personal taste. There are some of them like, with Fargo to me. I could have made a good enough case. Be like, okay, yeah, it could win. But yeah, LA Confidential. Good that's on there. I don't think it's an Oscar movie, but really good movie. As good as it gets, too. Really good movie as well. Jack Nicholson won the Oscar.
James L. Brooks does just wonderful work.
Yeah, Jack Nicholson. I I wish I could give him the Fountain of Youth. I could watch him all. For me, he's one of my favorite actors.
So, just a stupid question here. What happened to the 70th Academy Awards?
Were we just at the 70th?
Yeah, well, we were too. Yeah. Sorry. Okay. No, I was counting.
So now we're going to 70.
Because I went 69 to 71.
We're at 1999. Now here's a fun one.
This year.
So nominations for Best Picture: The Thin Red Line, Saving Private Ryan, Life is Beautiful, Elizabeth, and Shakespeare in Love, which won the Best Picture.
Harvey Weinstein knows how to win awards.
Oh, yeah.
That is clearly known. I also don't like him. There's something about him that I find kind of pervish, or I don't know what it is. Every time I see him when he's interviewed with people, he comes off kind of creepy to me. But Saving Private Ryan
is cleaned up. Gwyneth Paltrow, I'm not a Gwyneth Paltrow fan.
Judi Dench. I cannot believe she won Best
Actress. Best Original Screenplay. This is where I feel like the Academy really got it wrong. I feel like Saving Private Ryan is the clear choice here.
Yeah, for Best Picture.
Thin Red Line's really good, but I think it just happened to be there's a better war movie out the same year.
Yes.
And it's one of these cases when we talk about when it what John Madden. I didn't know he directed Shakespeare in Love during this football
game. What you're going to do is you're going to fall in love here and then write some plays over there.
He's
going to
undress you while you spin and you're falling in love.
And touchdown.
Yeah. And this is one of those few cases when we said now it's getting more regular. Steven Spielberg runs Best Director, but John Madden does not win Shakespeare Best Director and Picture. So it's one of the few cases back in the day. So I think we're in agreement that it should be Saving Private Ryan. And this is one that's kind of universal. People are like, yeah, that should have happened.
And you know what? Like Saving Private Ryan, like Shakespeare in Love. Have you seen it, by the way?
Yeah, once and a half.
It was okay. Like it was a good film.
It was nomination worthy, but to see that and be like that was the best picture of 1999, especially being even if Saving Private Ryan wasn't there, honestly I would give it to The Thin Red Line. I actually really like The Thin Red Line.
Yeah,
it's a really great
fair.
War film. So.
Yeah, I don't think Shakespeare in Love is going to stand the test of time. Or Sleepy Hollow. I think it's on for the 72nd Academy Award, so I saw it and said it. But no, I think
Sleepy Hollow for Best Picture.
Yes. Saving Private Ryan is just a wonderful, wonderful
film.
Yeah,
and that's a lot of those where, and you'll come up to one later on with Crash, spoiler alert, that it's one of these that does not stand the test of time, and it's one of the things in the moment where you're like, oh yeah, this is a good idea, and then later people are like, what? And I feel like, I like Forrest Gump too, but I feel like Forrest Gump was like that time, and I feel like now with a time capsule, Pulp Fiction would win, you know? Like, looking back.
Yeah.
So, nominees for the, are we at 1999 now?
Yeah.
Yeah, or, well, 1999, but
well,
the 2000.
Yeah.
So, nominees were The Sixth Sense. Wow, I did not know it was nominated. The Insider, The Green Mile. Fuck, Tom Hanks was always over the awards, wasn't he? The Cinder House and American Beauty. As a big fan of American Beauty, I'll say 100%.
American Beauty is one of my favorite movies of all time.
Yeah.
And, yeah, without a doubt. I mean, if anything else won, that would have been a travesty to how truly incredible American Beauty is.
It's something
in
else.
In all aspects.
It's fantastic, which is kind of weird. Spike Jonze got nominated for Being John Malkovich, not on the Best Picture.
I really liked Being John Malkovich,
me too. I would have took out probably Cinder House, to be honest.
I haven't seen that one. Also, The Green Mile was good, but I by no means did it deserve that. The Sixth Sense, I think, is more of a
cultural
phenomenon.
At the time, it to me felt like that masterpiece, where now, if fucking Shyamalan didn't do a twist every movie, he is hurt. Sixth Sense to me because he does a twist every movie.
Yeah,
that's the way I look at it. If he had only done this movie and the one twist, and there was never his movies again doing twists, I think this would be held up as like a horror masterpiece. But now it's looked as like, oh, the one he got right, and I hate
that.
See, I
disagree
great.
With that because I think Unbreakable.
True, but it doesn't get the same cred as.
That's true.
I have not seen Unbreakable.
Have you seen? Yeah, obviously you've seen it. I think if somebody were to do like an Unbreakable type film now, it would kill.
He wants to do a second one.
Which, well, he's an idiot. But also, I quite like Signs. May not be his best film, but I really enjoyed that one. But
yeah, same thing with, did it win Best Original Screenplay? Yeah, American Beauty, Clean House.
American
Original
Beauty
Screenplay,
is...
Kevin Spacey, Best Actor.
You know, it's actually one of the
best
few films I actually owned
is.
On DVD.
So
I used to buy like a lot of comedies because you kind of rewatch those.
Yeah.
But American Beauty is one I truly own.
It's kind of a comedy too. It has comedic aspects.
Oh, no, it does, without a doubt. But I mean, like, that's a film that I can just watch again and again. And I always find a different meaning in it, and it's just a great film.
Yeah, you're right about that. I can never not be... I never see it. I'm like, oh, I don't want to watch that. That's a movie I'll put on and just rewatch it.
And every time I've started dating a new girl, like second or third date, I make her watch American Beauty, and if she doesn't like
it... she breaks up.
No, if she doesn't like it, then you're out of here.
So now we're at the 2001, celebrating 2000 films. So the nominees for Best Picture, Traffic, Aaron Brockovich, Crouching Tiger, Chocolat, and then Gladiator.
I love Gladiator. I don't necessarily know if that was Best Picture. It was certainly a spectacle of a film.
Traffic was really good. Aaron Brockovich was good.
I always compare it to Braveheart.
Yeah.
But lesser? Yeah. There's something about... I think Braveheart, just to me, is a little bit more grittier. But, I mean, actually, I still quote Gladiator all the time.
I think...
Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, though. I wouldn't have been mad at that one. Because that is a very spectacle-heavy film that is so unique. I would have really liked that.
One thing I'll say, because it's very strange, like, oh, we won't do this with everyone. We're looking at Best Director. I really wish that if Gladiator won Best Picture, which it did, they should have gave it to Ridley Scott. Because he deserves a Best Director, I think, Academy Award, and he's not gotten it yet. So that's the one where I look at it, I'm like, man, I wish they would have doubled up and did that. Traffic's really good. Traffic is another one I see could have been there, but...
Aaron Brockovich, no, and Chocolat, no.
No.
For Best Picture.
I think Gladiator's good. It's almost like what we talked about earlier with some categories with, like, oh, it's not, like, a strong category, but it's the best there. Gladiator's kind of that. I like Gladiator a lot. I think it gets overhyped a lot to me.
Fair enough.
Like, I don't know. It's one of these, I guess... Because I hadn't seen it, everybody built it up, and I did see it. I'm like, that's really good, but no, I was not like, fuck, like, that is,
you know,
like...
You know what line I love, though, is, like, my name is Marcus Aurelius, and I will have my revenge in this life or the last... Oh, I say that all the time.
Obviously, you know, circumstances permitting. Yeah. So now, mostly when I'm drunk.
Oh, shit, what was the last one? American Beauty, oh, we thought was right. So Gladiator we thought was right. Okay, so far right's leading. A little spoiler alert.
Well, yeah, all right, okay.
So we'll see what the average... I feel like if it's 50-50, that's not a good average to me. Like, I want to see the percentage of, like, what they got right. So now 2002...
This one's wrong. It is wrong.
Are you going to say wrong for every year that Lord of the Rings does not win?
No, not necessarily, because I think the Two Towers is the weakest of the three, but...
So Best Picture was Moulin Rouge, Lord of the Rings, Fellowship of the Ring, In the Bedroom. I have not seen that. Gosford Park and A Beautiful Mind. Why do you think this is wrong? Because
I think the Lord of the Rings is... which was widely... viewed as an impossible adaptation. Yeah. It could not be filmed. And Peter Jackson did a phenomenal job with Fellowship of the Ring. I think he did a little too much CGI in the later two. But the Fellowship of the Ring is such a fantastical film that could have killed what is easily the best trilogy of all time.
Yeah.
And I think it deserved it. Like, A Beautiful Mind was good.
This is a strange fucking year. Look at this. Like, you have Denzel for Training Day. Training Day not for director or Best Picture. And Halle Berry for Monster Ball. No Best Picture.
Monster Ball was great.
But even then, Best Picture. But
David Lynch for Mulholland Drive. That was a great film.
Is where... Oh, yeah. He was nominated for that. Yeah, I saw that.
And, you know, A Beautiful Mind was safe to me. Like, it was... It was... Well, and, like, I like Ron Howard, but...
Screenplay just... Gosford Park. Even...
Yeah, and how the hell does Lord of the Rings not win for best adapted screenplay, for God's sakes?
Yeah.
Also, they did a terrible job of that actual adaptation, because the actual guy's a huge douchebag in real life.
I feel like terrible to his wife. I feel like Beautiful Mind definitely worthy, but I agree that Lord of the Rings, I think, should have took it. That's not just
without a doubt.
I think so. So we'll move on to, what are we at, 2003 now. So, Best Picture, here's a big doozy for you, because I feel like almost any one of these films I would
have... This one's wrong also, but I would have preferred, for a different reason.
Yeah. So, nominees, The Pianist, Lord of the Rings, Two Towers. Pianist. What did I say?
Pianist.
Yeah, The Pianist.
That's not how you say it. Pianist? It's The Pianist, yeah.
The Pianist. the Pianist, Lord of the Rings, Two Towers, The Hours. I've not seen The Hours, actually. What is The Hours? Sorry.
Then Gangs of New York and Chicago for Best Picture for that year.
And Chicago won. The Hours. Oh, okay. Oh, I have seen The Hours. Yeah. It's the second you see the poster, you're like, I've seen that. Wow, Nicole Kim looked different. Okay, so other than The Hours, because I don't remember it that well, I feel like there's three films I would have rather won. I would have rather Gangs of New York, I would have rather Two Towers, and even The Pianist I would have rather won.
Yeah. And it's funny.
And Rome Plants. See, it's funny. All the earlier,
also, Roman
later
Plants,
years,
I
won.
I'm so mad that they think Roman Polanski, they still allow him to be directed after his whole schnafu. But
that's what
schnafu.
We're
well, yeah. Okay, no, we were talking about this earlier. Now, Gangs of New York is a fantastic film, but its weakest point is Cameron Diaz with her half-hearted, half-there Irish accent. And if they would have gotten a different actress, that film would be an absolute classic, and I think would have won.
Nominated.
That being said, Chicago should not have won.
No, she did not get nominated. I agree that I still think even with that weak performance, Gangs of New York is better.
Yeah.
Than Chicago, I feel like
John C. Reilly was phenomenal.
Yeah, Two Towers is definitely better than
Chicago. I think the Two Towers is way. I think all four of those are better than Chicago. Not that Chicago didn't need to be nominated. It was not Best Picture.
No. And see you. Yeah, see Two Towers is my favorite. It's so funny. Oh really? I feel like Two Towers is always some of the people's weakest or their favorite. Helm's Deep for me is
being the Helm's Deep is the
whole time.
Without and I a love doubt.
The splitting up of the tribe. The fellowship.
Now, my only thing with the fellowship is I think it's the weakest of the three because I go like 10, 9.9, 10.
Yeah.
So, I mean, by no means do I think it's weak. No, but,
that's fair. No, they're all, for me, I cheat, but they're all 10 out of 10 films for me. I cheat. But, so that was, that was a wrong. So read out the nominee as well.
So for the best picture is Lost in Translation, Master and Commander at the Far Side of the World, Mystic River, Seabiscuit, and Lord of the Rings Return of the King.
That's a quick one. That's right. Sorry. Yeah. The only one I would have thrown up there is Mystic River, but that's if this didn't exist. If Return of the King is gone, Mystic River overall. Seabiscuit's fine. Whatever. Lost in Translation, good.
Master and Commander, I don't think is even close to being a Best Picture nomination.
No, I feel like that was just Gladiator hype. Of like, we really like Gladiator. Also,
to be honest, I didn't like Lost in Translation.
I like it enough.
I've rewatched it again, and I'm like, okay, I like it now, but I don't know.
So now we're at... 2005, honoring 2004, Best Picture nomination, Sideways, Ray, Finding Neverland, The Aviator, and Million Dollar Baby.
I'm fine with this. Neverland actually got nominated.
Yeah, good for them, but I'm fine with this, I think.
I wouldn't mind if Ray won, but I think Million Dollar Baby's a really good film.
Yeah, I think Sideways is your classic, like, Brooklyn nomination of, hey, this is this, like, kind of indie, Sideways was an indie, but it had that feel.
Also, I don't think Finding Neverland should have been nominated.
I've never seen it fully, so I can't say.
It is. It's very forgettable.
Yeah, that's
not bad, but just
and it's, The Aviator for me is one of.
I think Leo's weakest performance.
And Scorsese's too. It's there's not as good films for Scorsese, but I feel like The Aviator is one of those. So we feel like they got it right with Million Dollar Baby. Yeah.
Also, I would have put Hotel Rwanda actually in Best Picture over Finding Neverland.
I agree 100%. Actually, that was a great movie. 2006. It's 2005.
Been actually kind of cool to see the posters that they had for those as well.
Yeah, and later on it just switches to the host. It's funny because I did a little work just to see. Yeah. Now here's a bad one. Sorry, spoiler alert. So we're 2006, right?
Yes.
2006 Best Picture nominees: Munich, Good Night, Good Luck, Capote, Brokeback Mountain, and Crash. Now,
Crash should not have won,
and as you can see, Ang Lee won for Brokeback Mountain, but they couldn't go the full way to give, I would say, quote, probably the gay cowboy movie.
Yeah, which I think is an absolute shame. Is that what it's gotten?
To label that?
Yeah, labeled as.
Which is so much more. It's a love story.
Even I would have given Heath Ledger for Brokeback Mountain over. Not necessarily over Philip Seymour Hoffman, but he would have been my next pick.
Yeah, I agree.
But this is a really strong year, too.
It is, except for, I think, Crash. Capote's good. Good Night, Good Luck. But if you know, Crash good.
Gets, okay, no, for Best Director, Best Picture, not anything else.
No, and I feel like Crash, I remember that year, I had, that's kind of when I just started watching more adult films and whatnot. And I had seen, but these films I had seen all after the awards. So I saw Crash after, and even being like younger, being like, oh, it's a Best Academy Award nominee, like this is going to be good. And then seeing it, I was like, well, what?
And you know,
Matt Dillon did get for Officer John Ryan, which is fair because he was the only memorable part of that movie, in my opinion.
That is true. But you know, like after seeing like Capote, now Philip Seymour Hoffman's performance in that is phenomenal, but it's a boring film.
Yeah. Oh, wait, did Terrence Howard... No,
Terrence Howard didn't win, but he got nominated.
No, for Hustle and Flow, not for Crash, which he was also in. So, good year, but bad winner. That's funny. Let's see, 2007, honoring 2006. Oof, it's a close race on the right and wrong, folks. Departed, this is a full-on like win for me.
The Queen, Little Miss Sunshine, Letters from Iwo Jima.
Oh, sorry.
and Babel got nominated that year.
All good films.
But you know what? Little Miss Sunshine, another one. It's kind of like Brooklyn. It gets nominated for Best Picture. It's a fun little indie film. I love Little Miss Sunshine.
But not Best Picture of the year.
No. Letters from Iwo Jima, I wouldn't mind if that one. Not Babel. I didn't really like that one.
No.
Ale, I didn't realize Iñárritu did that one as well.
Yeah, he did that. And the other one I really like is 21 Grams. He did. Very good film.
He did 21 Grams too? Very good. I feel like I'm just learning his name now, but he's been around and doing great stuff for a while. Best but The actor, Departed. Also, why does it say Graham King?
Where?
For the next to The Departed. Like, isn't that Martin Scorsese's film though?
Producing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. That's why. See, so I agree. To me, that's one of my favorite. That's in my top 10. I love that movie. I was just looking at Forrest Whitaker just to see, and I just don't know if he.
That was a pretty good one, though.
Yeah, I guess so. I'd have to watch it again. It's been a long time. I've only seen it
once. I was definitely, like, at this time, like, I was, like, watching Braveheart all the time, and I was, like, really into Scotland, and The Last King of Scotland is not about Scotland.
Yeah.
So, spoiler.
Okay, so 2008, honoring 2009. Best Picture nominees, There Will Be Blood, Michael Clayton, Juno, Atonement, and No Country for Old Men. I feel like that's a big win. This me being a little biased, but No Country for Old Men, this is when I started to... Crash was the first year I actually started watching the awards. And this was the year I remember I saw No Country for Old Men in the theater. I actually got to see it. It was rare. My dad let me because I just... That was the emphasis of, like, me becoming, like, a film buff of, like, this movie looks really good. And I'd, like, start to know, like, who the Coens were. Like, I know, like, this is a Coen. Like, that's just the start of me starting to love film. And There Will Be Blood, great film. Michael Clayton, great film. But I feel like No Country for Old Men was truly
and the best. And Juno, there's another, like, indie thing.
Yeah, that's your darling. Like, here, throw this in. Like...
The one thing that bothers me, if you look at Best Actor, Johnny Depp for Sweeney Todd should not have been nominated. I like Sweeney Todd. No. I like Johnny Depp. That is not an Oscar-worthy performance. But I think Viggo Mortensen should have won over Daniel Day-Lewis. His character in Eastern Promises is really so good. And he's another guy that people forget, but every single thing he touches, the movie, maybe it's not the best, he himself is always phenomenal.
I will disagree with the Daniel Day-Lewis thing. I think Viggo was a good second, but I feel like Daniel Day did a good job.
I would have given it to Viggo.
So we're saying No Country for Old Men was right.
Yeah.
So this is 2008.
No, we argued about this.
So let's do the nomination. So Best Picture, The Reader, very good. That's what she won for, The Reader, not Little Children, sorry.
Yeah.
Kate Winslet, we were talking about. Milk. Fucking phenomenal. One of my all-time favorite movies.
Yeah, Frost Nixon.
Frost Nixon.
A little boring.
Yeah.
But not bad.
Curious Case of Benjamin.
Should
film.
Not have been nominated for Best Picture.
But yeah, I agree. And then Slumdog Millionaire won Best Picture.
I love Slumdog Millionaire.
Here's the thing we always talk about, and same thing why for Mad Max, I feel like The Dark Knight should have been nominated at least, maybe a potential win, because I like films that are great, but also change the landscape. Yes, it changed not the whole film landscape, but to me it gave us a superhero genre. It, to me, is the official birth of... Everyone loves this shit now. Kids, women, men, children. This was the first film of, like... It's like you saying, like, you know how good... Like, you saying, like... I feel the same way you do about Fellowship, about how it was adapted so well. This is like, look, this is a man dressing up in a fucking bat costume fighting crime, and look how well this movie is. This is not a comic book movie.
I agree that it should have been nominated, but I think Slumdog Millionaire tells a story. If you look at every single one of them, they're about white men.
Yeah.
Slumdog Millionaire takes... From a
that's true.
A point of view from an Indian, a minority race in America, a lower class person, and tells a really captivating story with great visuals, just everything about it is so unique, and that's why I am totally fine with it winning Best Picture.
I just feel like for me, I like, and I get those points are definitely valid, and I think it's a very good movie. It's a movie that I've actually only watched twice, and I feel like I never really need to watch again. And up until I've met you, there's nobody else that talks about this movie. And that's why I feel like it's a great movie and could be a great nomination. I wouldn't take it out of nomination, but I feel like Dark Knight, because it changed landscape, and it's just... I think it's an incredible piece. I understand why it didn't win. I feel like I would probably have taken...
I would have taken Frost Nixon out. Or Curious Case of
Benjamin Button. I wouldn't take Frost Nixon because they love that shit. I would take Benjamin Button out. The Reader's actually really good. If you've seen The Reader, it's actually...
Yeah, it is a good film. I don't know. No, it's not really my cup of tea.
So it's the thing. It's not so much Slumdog winning. I still feel like I would obviously rather Dark Knight. I'm very biased. It's my favorite movie, favorite character. So I know I'm biased. So that's why I kind of go like, oh yeah, I get it. But I at least would like the nomination. And even then, to be honest, if just be playing with these, I would have put Milk there. Honestly, I like Milk a lot more. I'm not going to put this in the right or wrong because we can't agree, so it's in the middle, so that's up for debate.
Okay.
But I liked Milk more.
Okay.
Then
the one thing that I just want to point out, so Sean Penn won for Best Actor, which he definitely deserves. That was a great film, but I kind of think Mickey Rourke was a little robbed on that. Any other year, I think he would have won it. I loved him in that. But in this one,
a little bit of performance, and it fit once again with the times.
Yes, and like without a doubt, Sean Penn. Movement. By no means am I saying Sean Penn doesn't deserve it for that one, but I think Mickey Rourke. I think kind of people forget how good he was.
But I'm kind of glad he didn't, because we talked about this offcast, he won it, and then he just went on to go make shit movies, right? Where Sean Penn, at least, like, there might be a bad movie here and there, but he's still trying to do quality. 2010, Best Picture nominee. Now, here is when we talk about many times. This is when you can tell there was... And I think it's this. They never said this, but everyone complained why wasn't Dark Knight nominated. And it's like, oh, we'll fix the problem. Here's 10 nominations.
And there's a lot that should not be nominated.
No, and it's that thing of like, oh... So
it's Up in the Air,
yeah,
Up, A Serious Man, Precious based on the novel Pushed by Sapphire, Inglourious Bastards, An Education, District 9, The Blind Side, Avatar, The Hurt Locker.
I take out Avatar, I take out Blind Side.
Blind Side was
out,
terrible.
Blind Side, leave her in for Sandra Bullock, sure, but I
that
take
is,
out
no,
Avatar.
No, I take, no, no, Sandra Bullock did not deserve that actress either.
Who was she up against? Helen Mirren already won, Karen Mulligan, Education, meh,
Gabrielle Sidibe, I would have given her
no,
that one.
I wouldn't.
She or at least Meryl Streep.
But Meryl Streep wins 10 other times. But yeah, no, if you watch her in American Horror Story, if you watch her in anything else...
Yes, but this was the first time that she had done this. This is how she came on the screen, and now I feel
Monique was better, and who won?
No, not Best Supporting.
No, I know, but I mean, like, Monique was better,
okay,
she won, so
yeah.
I'm fine with it.
But man, you know what? The Blind Side is the... Like, first of all, it takes a story about, like... And just turns it into, like, white guilt, and how it was, like, the white man that saved him. So it's a terribly racist film. And it's just, I don't think it's good. I also don't think Sandra Bullock's character was all that strong. She annoyed me throughout the whole thing. She also stole a kid. Nobody talks about that in the movie.
Well, in real life, she adopted
no,
that
yeah,
kid, Liam.
No, yeah, but she literally just found the kid. Oh, you can play football? Oh, I'm going to benefit off you. Terrible.
So anyways, the Hurt Locker won.
Which I don't think it deserved to.
We won't get into, I don't think.
I think it won.
I think it deserved.
Because of James Cameron.
I think it deserved over because literally the only talk was between Hurt Locker and Avatar. I remember this is definitely when I was in full film, like fanboy mode. I did not want Avatar to win at all. I was pulling for Inglourious Bastards. But now, in retrospect, you know what I would rather win out of all these?
I'd pick District 9.
Actually. True, that's fucking
District
true.
District 9 is a unique film, and I think it's phenomenal, and I kind of wish he would have kept up with
Halo.
It. AKA Halo? Yeah, pretty much. I liked Up. I liked Up in the Air. Serious Man was good. Precious was great. But
Bass
the
really
Avatar
good.
Is such a derivative story.
The Avatar.
Can you even tell me the main character's name?
What? Jack.
Jake Sully.
Damn, I was close.
It is, and it's literally just a carbon copy of Fern Gully, Dance
Pocahontas.
With the Wolves. And there's no way that should have been Best Picture. Yeah.
But that's why...
But also, The Hurt Locker is... I don't like it.
It's,
I didn't think it was a good film.
I think it's good, but I think there's better films on there.
Yeah,
but
considerably
I would
films.
Rather... If it's the lesser of two evils between that and Avatar, I would have picked Hurt
but
Locker.
But I think they got that wrong.
I do too, but yeah. I still would have picked Hurt Locker over Avatar.
This is an interesting year.
But it's still so huge again. It's like, fuck. It's like... Now they're at 8, but 10 is just so much. Winter's Bone, True Grit, Toy Story 3, Social Network... The Kids Are Alright, Inception, The Fighter, Black Swan, 127 Hours, and King's Speech. I really like King's Speech. This is a personal taste. I won't. It's the same thing as I think we said about Gladiator. I wouldn't say they got wrong, but there's other films. Maybe
I think The Fighter. The Fighter.
I love The Fighter.
The Fighter was great. Toy Story 3, great film. So was True Grit. So was Winter's Bone.
But literally right. For Best Picture, I would rather The Fighter or Toy Story 3.
I think the
Social Network.
The Social Network, I think, is more of a...
Spotlight?
Not Spotlight, but it seems like it was very topical at the time, and it was a great story. It's very well done, but I don't think it was the best picture. Neither was Inception.
No. But I'm glad I got nominated, though.
Also, I don't think 127
but
Hours was
I feel
that
like
great.
Don't you feel like the Inception was kind of their apology for The Dark Knight?
I do as well, because I think that is one of his weaker films.
Yeah. I'll disagree. That's
do you think it's Interstellar?
Yeah. Interstellar to me is his weakest movie.
See, I think Interstellar is where the spectacle beats the story, but and I think Inception's a better story, but there's just something about space that I like.
Yeah.
But I think The Fighter should have won.
Some about dreams I like.
Yeah.
Hashtag Freddy.
Hashtag Freddy.
But yeah, so King's Speech is so good, but I'd stay wrong just for personal opinion, but I can see why it won.
Yeah.
So it's one of those, like, I'm putting it in the wrong column, but it's like, it's very slight, so I'll kind of give them the point.
Yeah.
2012... This is a year...
They fucked this year up.
This is a year that I think, though, that it's kind of weak. War
it's
Host.
It's a really weak
Tree
year.
Tree of Life, Moneyball, Brad Pitt's all over the place. Midnight, still didn't win an Oscar. Midnight in Paris, Hugo, The Help, Extremely Loud, Incredibly Close.
I had no idea.
I
did not like that one.
I didn't even know. I actually still haven't seen it. The Descendants and The Artist. The Artist, I would say wrong, because I feel like they just gave it because it was a black and white movie. I know it's appreciative, but it's like, so what, do we want to, old movies making, us making kind of tributes to old movies I think could be nominated and appreciated, but I feel like they shouldn't win Best Picture. I guess I'd rather The Descendants. There's not really any movie on here I feel that strongly about. I really like Moneyball as well.
I really like The Help as well.
There's no movie on here that I'm like, man, that really should have won to me. This is...
It's just a weak year.
Out of all the years we've done so far, even when on weak lists, there's usually one film where you're like, you know what, that's a standout great film. But this, to me, is one in your weaker years. So,
oh, without a doubt.
I do we put this in the right or wrong? The whole year, I think, is weak.
Well, I'm just looking at who else was, like, nominated for, or what other, oh, I loved Rango. That was my
favorite. So you think Rango should have won?
No, but I'm just, I didn't realize it'd come out that year. This is
2012, right? So 2011.
Yeah, I really, really like that movie.
What superhero movie count 2011? But no, I almost don't really have an opinion on this because I feel like this year for me, there was nothing really amazing. Why did they pick
the oldest picture of Meryl Streep?
I don't know.
It's an interesting choice that they have everybody else from the event when they won, but it's Meryl Streep from the 80s for some reason.
So how do you feel? Is this a right or wrong for you?
I think it's wrong because I think there had to have been better films that year.
Yeah. And I've seen The Artist once, never gone back and watched it.
I think Moneyball was overall a better film than The Artist. Yeah. I think it's going to...
I think The Artist won for the gimmick, to be honest, of being black and white.
I agree.
Yeah.
I don't think this is a right year. Also, The Beginners didn't get nominated, and it should have. Oh, my God. This has to be my favorite host of the Oscars, the 85th. Academy Awards. Seth MacFarlane was so funny in these ones because I think he just kind of took the piss out of it a little bit, and I think that pissed a lot of people off.
Yeah.
But
so which now is this good. Is this is what we've talked about before privately, but nominees: Zero Dark Thirty. Thank God it did win. Sorry, spoilers. Zero Dark Thirty, Silver Linings Playbook, Lincoln, Life of Pi, Les Misérables. Shout out to you, John Travolta. Django Unchained, Beasts of Southern Wild. Amour, and then Argo. I'm fine with this. I think the controversy is that
Ben Affleck didn't get nominated for Best Director.
Yeah, not even win. Didn't even get nominated. I feel like it's the best. The only one for me is Django, but I'm fine with that not winning Best Picture because Argo was a
great film.
Argo's really good. It holds up. Like, I know it's only been a few years, but every time I watch it, it's really... I almost thought about that this weekend of, like, I wish I wasn't going out of town because I'm like, man, I just want to watch Oscar films.
The only one that I would have liked to see is Silver Linings Playbook get a little bit more recognition because I thought that was just a wonderfully directed film.
Yeah,
but
she got that was the start of the J-Law, you know, train. Let's see, where are we at now? 2014, honoring 2013, Best Picture. This is a really good year, actually. The Wolf of Wall Street.
Philomena,
Nebraska, really good. Her fucking so good. Her,
is oh, I loved
good.
Her.
This is such a good year. Gravity, I actually really like Gravity. Dallas Buyers Club, really good. Captain Phillips, good.
I think it's a little one of the weaker ones in this one. Same with American Hustle.
But. I agree. I disagree. I love American Hustle. I think it wouldn't be on there if there was not these much nominations. Yes, but with these, I think it's great.
See, my problem with American Hustle is there's nothing wrong with that film, but there's nothing fantastic about the film.
True.
It was very well directed. It's just a fun watch. Very well acted. It was very well... everything was very well done, but nothing blew me out of the water like some of these films did. But 12 Years a Slave,
I think. 12 Years a Slave, yeah, I think we're both on that one. That's right. I that's a really great film. It's really depressing and hard to watch. Like, it's not a film I'd watch over and over, but I think this year the controversy is more in the acting categories with we've talked about earlier about the best supporting an actor. Like,
I don't think Christian Bale for American Hustle, I don't think he deserved a nomination.
Yeah, maybe
he was good, but I don't think he was anything fantastic. I think Her got snubbed though for a lot of awards because that is a very unique, special film.
Yeah, and the last year on our list coming up, Best Picture, Whiplash, Theory of Everything, Selma, Imitation Game, Grand Budapest Hotel, Boyhood, and American Sniper.
And Birdman.
Oh shit! And the winner, Birdman. And the winner, Birdman. I'm pretty fine with that. I like Birdman a lot. It's really good. The only one, truthfully, on this list I would have thought is Whiplash because I fucking love Whiplash. I actually, for some reason, like Whiplash.
I've yet to see it actually.
Oh,
I know. I've heard nothing but good things about it.
But I'm completely fine with Birdman. It's a really, really well done film.
Yeah, it is.
And
such a good movie. I
was
so
happy. That didn't win her. Oh, it won over Boyhood. That was the other big one because Boyhood.
If Boyhood would have won, I would have been mad. Boyhood, I loved to me, Boyhood, but
I didn't. I appreciated the film technique, but I didn't like that it was the artist thing again. Like, it's a gimmick of the 12 years. I think the actual substance of the film was not that good.
No, that's the weakest part of it.
Yeah.
But no, I think Birdman without a doubt. So what is the score that we're at?
We are at.
It's gonna be tied, isn't it?
It was close. So there was, we said 9 Oscars had it wrong, and, 9, and then 11 got it right.
Okay.
So we did 20 years
in total. You're lucky this time, the Academy.
So they, but even then, so what is that? That's, it got two right more than it got wrong. So I feel like
that's not great odds.
It's not great odds. It's like, it's like they still got more right in our opinion, but it's not the greatest odds. So we'll see this year. Hopefully Mad Max wins in our opinions, and it kind of adds another one in the right column. But yeah, is there anything you want to say before we exit off on this Oscar special?
No, but I'm just excited for this one. I'm excited how Chris Rock's going to host it.
Yeah, should be fun.
Which was the year that Ellen DeGeneres did it. Whatever year that was, it was terrible. It was boring.
Was that last year or the year before?
Yeah, because Billy Crystal did it this year prior, which was great. Eh.
I love Billy Crystal.
I love Billy Crystal too, but I thought it was just kind of eh.
Yeah.
But I'm excited for Chris Rock. I think it's going to be fun.
Well, enjoy the Oscars. Have some fun. Wait for awkward moments and whatnot. And
yeah, oh my god, if there's another John Travolta to go on, and the wickedly talented Adima Manzala, or whatever
he said. Adele Dazeem.
Adele Dazeem.
We'll leave it at that, folks. That was a good one.